Testing, 1, 2, 3. This will be the Citizen Budget Committee meeting for June 7th, 2018.
Regular Citizen Budget Committee meeting. Everyone will join me in standing for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, so first we'll open to public comment. And then do we have a motion to approve the minutes from the May 24th, 2018 meeting?
I had a question on those minutes. In particular, there was, I had made a request for a certain document, the insurance program, and maybe there was a bit of confusion because I think that what I didn't want was a policy, and certainly not if it was the employee benefits policy. I was more interested in like a summary of your proposal of insurance, like your entire program, property liability program.
So what we sent you originally was, you're correct, it was the entire policy document for property and liability. What page number was it?
About 155.
If you go to page 155 in that document, it has, I believe, the summary that you're looking for.
And you go to page 155 in that
document.
And you do have one policy that covers all of your liability exposures and your property?
Yeah, the only thing that's with a separate company is flood insurance.
Wow, that's interesting.
Yeah, that's how it is in government. You tend to get all of your property liability work comp all through the same carrier.
Wow.
Unless you self-insure.
Okay, good. And this is 155?
Yeah, but if you can't find it, just call us and we'll...
Yeah. I just didn't want to, I mean, that was, you know, these documents y'all are sending out are pretty hefty.
There's a lot of stuff in them, it's true.
Yeah.
All right.
I will second Temporary Chairman Rutter's motion to accept the minutes from... I'll make a motion to accept the minutes from last meeting.
Okay.
Millie Sims?
Yes.
Larry Rucker? Excuse me, I'm sorry. Larry Whitney?
Yes.
Andrew Schlar?
Yes.
Vice Chairman Kevin Rucker?
Yes.
We were in a very long training today.
Yeah.
We were in a very long training today.
Yes.
So our minds are still
today.
Oh, yeah,
the business.
Oh, my gosh.
Okay.
All right, so
we're ready. So, we'll have on the agenda, discuss, take action on ideas for final report recommendations.
All right.
Turn it over.
So, let me, if you will indulge me, give you a quick overview of kind of where I think we're at in terms of documentations and process so far. So the risk, the values and risk analysis documents that we've put out as a tool for you all to use. The first set of presentations, I think we had 4 of 7 committee members complete those and submit them. The second set of presentations, we've had 2 of 7 committee members complete and submit them. So I'm just sort of stating that. I had told you early on that was a tool for you all to use. It was really your decision as to how you wanted to proceed with that. But at this point, based on that information, we've got another set of presentations at the next week's meeting. I'll still put those together for you all and send them out if you want them. But at this point, it doesn't appear that the group as a whole is using them or needing them, I guess. But if it's useful to you, just have that list of all the things that they do in one spot, we can still put that together. Just kind of looking for some feedback there from you. And you don't have to answer now unless you're ready to.
Well, I would make a comment to say that the lists were all different.
Yeah.
And some of them were just lists of duties that we perform, I guess. So it was a little difficult, but I would be interested.
to you. Did you bring the hard copies?
Yeah, I have them. I mean, like she said, we only had four from the city clerks and the fire, and there's only been two that have been sent in for the support service, recreation, and public works. So,
Yeah, we can email those to you if you want, so you can see what's there so far, however you want to do it.
Or if you're planning on, you know, doing
it. Oh, you're planning on combining them. You just can take
Well, we already did.
A new cell or something.
That was our plan. I mean, but not having a complete group of set of seven, it didn't seem to serve as much of a purpose without that. So, so what we'll do, how about this? We'll send you all electronically what we have so far. We'll put the average column in there because that's the easy formula, and then you can do with it what you will. And then, if, you know, if you guys decide to use it differently in the next few meetings, we will certainly re-engage on that. So we'll do that. That's okay with everybody. And then just a couple other things. You have also in your stack in front of you the latest list of ideas. You know, we've been writing them down as you all have been throwing things out at us. So that's one of the things we'd like to kind of work through a little bit tonight to talk about some of these things and whether they're going to end up in your final report recommendations. But the bulk of the time, at least from the presentation side on our end, we would like to spend by going over the latest financial forecast with you. So we gave you one at the very start of our meetings. This is the adjusted version based on, you know, revenue and expenditure adjustments as we've been working on building the budget for next year and looking at the forecast for the additional 4 years. So I would like to go over that with you so you can see kind of where we're at. We've also, as we discussed here, added different millage rates in, like we've talked about before. So if you'll allow me for just a few minutes, I'd like to go through this with you. So the usual spreadsheet, the first page is a five-year forecast based on today's millage rate, which is 8.1518. Okay, so this reflects just status quo, with no other changes, no recommendations, you know, just where we're at. So if you look at the 17-18 column, you can see at the very, I guess the easiest way to do it is if you go to the very bottom where it says fund balance, we're projecting to end the year at, is it 591 or 595? So fund balance, we put a little extra money into fund balance at the end of this fiscal year, and we end the year with a reserve number of $595,000. So that's what that's telling you. Okay. So again, keeping the millage rate the same for the remaining 5 years, if you follow along that same last line row of numbers, you'll see that at 18-19 at the end of the year, we have used more of fund balance because expenditures and revenues are not keeping pace. And then you can see in 19-20, we basically start going into the negative, so we no longer have reserves. So that is this scenario, like we started the conversation at the beginning of our meetings, is the reason why our current millage doesn't work with our current expenditure and revenue levels. Okay. All right, so flipping, yes.
What is the major driver for the fund balance to decrease over time?
Well, the two lines I'd tell you to focus on would be, they're in bold, there's a total revenue line, and then further below that, there's a total expenditure line, right? Do you see those two? So if you look at those, and just start with 18-19, you can see that we bring in revenues of $11.8 million, but our expenditures are $12.1
million. Okay, so one of the major drivers is $1.5 million increase in personnel.
Correct.
So, understand that personnel and operating, the way that we had set it up for 17-18, I had strictly just taken the salaries and put them in there. But if you look at our departments, the way that they lay out, we also have a general government department where we pay out the retirement contributions for our general employee pension plan, the health insurance for our retirees, etc. So from 18-19 and going forward, what I was trying to do was, if you looked at our budget for 18-19 and looked at the personnel and added all those departments together, you can get to that total, which includes that Department 19, and it also includes the pension cost for the state that we have to pay out and the state reimburses us for. So the difference really, if you totaled the personnel and operating for 17-18, and you totaled the personnel and operating for 18-19, you need to put those two together to really figure out what the difference is, because
she just moved around.
We moved it around, so it's 10.5 to 10.7 is what you said.
So I guess another question is, what percentage increase per year did you estimate, and how did you estimate that? Is it adding more personnel, or is it just salary increases?
So the typical salary increase is the COLA, the 2%. What's also in here is the SRO estimate, because we're looking to add two additional SROs, school resource officers. So we've had to include that. And then we just finished our salary survey, so those numbers are in there as well, to be able to estimate across those, so we all, when the salary survey comes into play, you can see how those numbers would play out as well. Does that make sense?
So, anyway, the bottom line is that this is 8 million, I'm sorry, Cindy, just to catch you back up, the front page is keeping the same millage, 8.1518, mm-hmm. all 5 years.
Yeah. So the total increase for that year in personnel and operating is 149,644.
Which is the increase in salary benefits?
Salary benefits, pension costs.
That's our whole discussion. That's my end of the conversation.
Okay.
One more quick question. One of the things that we had picked up earlier on is that the pension funds are underfunded right now, according to the actual rules. Is that a budget finding? I mean, is that an audit finding?
No, because they're not unfunded. They're just not fully funded, but they're not unreasonably unfunded. That's not kind
of that makes sense, but they're based on actuarial, so
right.
There is a gap there, but it's still in an acceptable range.
Right.
Okay.
That's exactly right.
In the private sector, they're fully funded because they may go out of business tomorrow.
Right.
We don't go out of business, so we are able to do partially funded. So it's around, let's say, anything less than 75% funded is considered to be
probably
good. Right.
Yeah. Okay. Page 2.
I would like to make a motion, actually, to see if we can get a sense of where we are, I guess. I move that we add a recommendation to our final report to keep the millage rate at 8.15 for at least next year's budget.
Okay.
Do we have the, I guess we can recommend anything as a group, but that sounds like we're supposed to be making recommendations.
Well, we have only two meetings to discuss this and make recommendations for the report, I think, because the next meeting we have, the police is going to do a report and we'll have to ask questions, we'll run out of time. So I figure let's get started with writing our report, because by the next meeting that we have where there's no presentations, we're going to have to draft it, right? Because then the July would.
Well, I didn't hear a second, so I'm not sure what we're discussing.
I didn't hear it first.
Well, I made a motion, but if no one seconds it, then that's okay. I mean, we move on, but I want to get the conversation started.
I'll just say I don't see any way to second it without enough information. You're making a statement to say the state's the same, and I don't have enough information to be comfortable with that.
Plus, we're missing two members.
What information do we need, I guess, is the question. Do they have plans here to show us their forecasts, right?
I'm not comfortable with them because that's saying we're having. I'm not comfortable with that, no.
Not with mine. I mean,
me either.
That's looking at, to me, it's a very narrow view to do that when what they're not showing here is kind of the things that I was asking for is what should the budget, instead of what the budget is for 17, 18, or 18, 19, what should it be if we were to fund all the different things that we need to do properly. The expenses are totally based on revenue. But the expenses are actually, should be higher than what the revenue is, and I think we need to review that very carefully. Things that are within the realm of the city, responsibilities that have been underfunded for a very long period of time, they need to get funded.
But I also think that things that are currently funded by the city, maybe funding reductions should be applied to some of the things that we're doing.
Yeah, I guess I would say, like some of the other members, I haven't seen an opportunity where we can reduce it at this point. You know, I think we need to see more information, but I'm kind of with the committee. I wouldn't feel comfortable, you know, saying status quo right at this point.
Press on, I guess, with that.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Okay, so page two is similar to the version you saw previously where we gave you, I think, 3 millage rates, kind of all on one page. This one, however, just puts 5 together, some of the different ones we've talked about. If you were to go back to one of the earlier forecast models we gave you, we showed you an 8.4 millage rate model. So this is the range of rates from 8.4 to 9.0, just for really your observation purposes, if nothing else. Now, the easiest way for me to sort of get you down to the most pertinent parts of this would be if you look at there's two pages to this. So the very bottom of page one, there's the net position, and there's
the very bottom of the second page she's on.
I'm sorry, the 5 minutes. Okay, so page two of your staple documents, which
the
has a
label page two?
No. Okay, it's labeled. Let me start again. Let's do it visually. So here's the staff. Second page. Turn one page over.
Do that.
And then you're looking at a document that says 5-year financial forecast, June 7, 2018, 5 millage rates, and it is labeled page one. This is correct. Alright, so at the very bottom of that page, there's a series of rows that say net position at, and then it has the millage rate. So this represents the net effect of each of those fiscal years at that specific millage rate, what happens, revenues and expenditures going forward. So just for talking purposes, we're on the same page. If you look at net position at 8.4, you can see that in fiscal year 18-19, you end up at a deficit. You're at 106,000. Not in a good position, right? If you follow that all the way along, at the end of 5 years, you only have $140,000 in reserves at 8.4, with the currently projected revenues and expenditures.
So the net position is equivalent to reserves? You just changed the terminology.
So, no, I'm sorry.
This is an addition or deletion against the reserve fund?
Yes,
that's an addition. The next
except in 1819, there will be a reduction in reserve.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. So have I confused everyone?
Just me.
Okay. All right. So you can see those numbers. You can see them for all the different millage rates. You can see that, like, at 8.691, you'd be at 438,000 at the end of the 5 years. You'd be positive all the way across. Let's flip over to the next page, and then let me show you the rest of this. So what we did on the top of this page is the numbers you saw at the end of the preceding page. Then we said, well, we still need money to go into capital assets to handle all the infrastructure issues we've been talking about. Right. So this programs some money, not all the money we need, Larry, to your point, but it programs a significant portion over the 5 years. And then below that, you'll see more net position lines. That is after transfers to capital assets. That's what that represents. So for example, at net position 8.4 after transferring to capital assets, you can see we are in a negative state the entire 5-year period if we transfer that money to capital assets. We move down to 8.691, you can see that we're positive a couple years and then we go negative. And you can see how that sort of flows with the subsequent millage rates. Moving down just a little bit on that spreadsheet, the last section where it says fund balance reserves, it says $645,000, and then you have again a net position line. Each of those lines is where you would ultimately end up with reserves. If you take the net position from the prior page, you add in money into capital assets, this is where you end up. So net position at 8.4, for example, FY18-19, you would have $438,000 in reserves. But you can see because of the flow of the money during the next 5 years, you only at the end of 22-23 end up with $120,000 in reserves, which is why that's a tenuous position to be in. At the net position 8.691, you can see how it's at the end of 18-19, you have $681,000 in reserves, and it continues to build up a little bit. You're still roughly in the same place at the end of that time period. So all of these are just multiple scenarios to kind of show you how these things could flow if we change the millage rates in one of those ways. Anybody have any questions before I go to the very next page, which is actually the staff recommended millage rate plan?
Why did you say
it was going
to go to 9 to 9 and
then
go to 10?
We just did, I mean, we have so many scenarios on here, we just didn't add another one. You certainly could, you know.
Well, just to see.
Yeah.
So why don't we set it to 10, and when do we restrain? What happens when we overspend that 10%? Then we're stuck, right? So.
Well, 10 is where you'd be. That is the max. So.
Can I comment, Larry? One of the other reasons we didn't really go any further than we have to, because the reserve goal is the 15% of your operating. So if you see the net position at 9 at the end of 5 years is $2,092,000, and we only really have to be at 18, so we would get where we needed to be.
Functionally and arithmetically, that makes perfect sense.
We can add 10. I have no issue with that.
The reason I'm asking is not because I want to see the military at 10, but I want to see the numbers that it generates. And the reason is because although you're looking at these, okay, they're always based on assumptions. One of the assumptions in here is that we don't spend $750,000 for a storm this year. Okay? So all of a sudden, all these things go in the negative. And if they're already in the negative, what do we do? That means we don't fix anything during the storm and everybody's going around. What do we want to live with as a community? And that's extremely important. This city spent a lot of time and effort getting the reserves up. And please don't quote the number, but I'm just generalizing. That's like to about 1.2 million. We had two storms. Neither one was major, and yet we used up two-thirds of our reserve. So is it reasonable to extend these numbers and suggest that this is great, providing we don't have a storm? Does anybody believe that would happen?
Well, why are the storms so expensive? What did we spend the money on? Did we spend it on debris cleanup? Did we spend it on repairing things? Or did we spend it on overtime for fire and police to sit in their buildings during the storm? I mean, there's a lot of components to this, right?
All of the above.
Well, there's the relative parts of that, I guess, right? What was the big spend?
They're all big numbers. Yeah. I mean, I have a spreadsheet that I can show you everything we submitted to FEMA.
Yeah.
And it brings with me.
FEMA reimburses us for the debris.
No, wait. I'm sorry, I don't mean to cut you off. One of the big problems is FEMA is not reimbursing us at a rate that they're supposed to. We're 2 years behind right now, and there's no guarantee we'll ever see the money. They owe us how much? Just about $500,000, something like that.
Yeah, easily.
They still owe us money from Matthew.
Yeah.
All right, Irvin, Matthew is still waiting about $187,000.
I think it's 5 or 6 to get.
Yeah, somewhere between 5 and 6 is what we're waiting on.
Right, and the point is, right now, I mean, what I'm hearing, and some of this is hearsay, but I'm hearing that FEMA's going back and looking at a lot of these cities and determining that many of those cities that they asked for, they're not getting. They just struck things off the list so that they can save them less money than anything at all. So somehow, some way, we have to plan for that. But that's a reality. To assume we're not going to have any storms in the next 5 years is, to me, not reasonable. It's not a good assumption.
Well, and I also don't like to assume that FEMA's going to pay us. Well, to that point, the point that you could get a different FEMA reviewer, you know, tomorrow, and they could take all your projects and say you lose. And also, there have been stories, although I've never experienced it, where FEMA has come back years after they've given us city money, and then they've demanded it back because they did some sort of analysis and decided, you know, you shouldn't have gotten whatever it was.
So therefore, everything that you're saying suggests that you can't really rely on FEMA in terms of budgeting and trying to predict and control your future events. You just cannot do it.
I would not.
And therefore, we have to be able to subsidize ourselves for something like that. If and when FEMA, the way I'm looking at it from an accounting perspective, if and when FEMA ever sends money back, it goes into the general fund, we reprocess for the next year, and we come down with a different military. But we have to have money for a storm.
I agree wholeheartedly.
Does that make sense to everybody, what I said, or is that?
I don't understand what costs so much when we have a storm now.
Well, that's a different issue.
Yeah, we have insurance that covers.
Insurance
is the end result after insurance and paybacks and everything.
I mean, we had a storm blew through, and no one comes to pay.
So we had buildings and equipment. So for Matthew, we had $132,000 in debris cleanup, $92,000 in emergency protective, which means the police and fire costs.
And public works, yeah.
And public works. The idea that they sit through the storm is an incorrect assumption. We took two people to the hospital and picked up trucks across the bridge in the middle of a hurricane during Irma, I think, because the county ambulance goes across the bridge and leaves the service area. We respond to, I can't count the calls because people drink during hurricanes. I mean, if we could eliminate the alcohol content in the city during a hurricane, we wouldn't have half the problems that we have, but they respond to calls all night long. Until it gets to be entirely too dangerous, our public works people are out cleaning storm drains the whole storm, so your house doesn't flood. So those are incorrect assumptions. The other issue is we have to be here when the storm is over to get to the down power line so people are willing to be amazed at how hard they are to see. I mean, so those are things that we have to be here for. I have to be here to prove money. We have, you know, I slept in my office. We all sleep good. We do not want to be here, trust me. We'd rather be home with our families. So the idea that we just sit through the hurricanes is
completely. Well, the services are provided because there are electrical services right. That function. So there's general health, safety, and welfare. Services in the
we put out three fires during Matthew and two during Irma. So we don't, you know, we don't sit and sit around and eat.
The other thing about storms and hurricanes, if it's a wet storm, which even when they're not, even if we're not on the wet side, we still get a lot of rain. And as we have discussed here, our stormwater situation, our pipes, we're very, very old, and we don't have enough money in the budget to repair that at a rate that would reduce our costs.
As we've discussed, stormwater has a separate fund that's funded through the utility charges on our bill, not through ad valorem, and we need a plan on how we're going to use that money fiscally responsibly to slowly solve our problem. Right? So that separate that from...
That's
that
in your packet tonight. We're actually going to get to that.
Yeah, I saw it.
Your point is taken financially, but all I'm saying is as long as you have a stormwater issue and you get wet storms, it's going to end up being a problem on the side of it for other expense because storms are not going away right after the storm's over. It leaves a lot of problems.
So anyway, we had $4,000 in road and bridges damage for Matthew, $51,000 in building and equipment, $51,000 in parks and recreation, and we received $30,000 in insurance. So the rest we filed FEMA. For Matthew, we have received $226,000, and we're waiting on $74,000. In Irma, we had a lot more damage in Irma, so did everyone. We received about $127,000. From our insurance company, we spent $650,000, and we are receiving, hopefully, from FEMA, $518,000, but we have not received any funds for that. And no city at this point of our county has received any funds from.
So my comment would be, okay, let's plan for that. sure. But that's, let's not plan for 365 days of that along the way, right? So we don't have to staff or fund for knowing that we're going to get blown out by a storm.
I don't understand the 365 part.
Well, I'm saying that, what am I trying to say? I guess like the fire department, we staff it to meet the two-in, two-out rule for hazardous fires, right?
I'm not sure that's true. I'm not sure that's true. That's a minimum rule, right?
Well, no. The data says, and the survey said, in 2000, sometime in 2004 or something, we went from three people to five people.
Right.
Right? And so now we staff at that level. And the criteria that I've been told all the time is it's two-in, two-out rule. So I looked into the two-in, two-out rule, and it's for fireman safety, which we don't want to send our guys in to kill them, right? So we want to keep them safe. But it's for imminent danger situations and scenarios. And how many of those come up across the year? Of the 1,500 calls we get to the fire department, how many of those? And if we had to wait an extra 10 or 15 minutes for a county to bring another truck down so that there were enough people at the fire to enter, what's the risk of that?
Huge. 15 minutes at the fire.
But what if there's no people in the building, but it's an imminent danger to the guys going in, then they won't go in. That's what we're trying to save, right? Not saving anybody's life, because...
To me, it's just simple. The fire department is not a productivity issue. It is an insurance issue for the city. You keep it there for the, you have a fully funded and operating fire department for the unlikely events that things occur.
We have $1 million in debt in trucks, and we have $1 million in costs for running the fire department.
I said
we have 2% of the calls are fire, and of those, how many have required this two in two
out rule? I think we need to have a further discussion.
And what about the other cities and around us, right? How do they meet it? We help them meet it. Right? By stocking our shelves full of all these supplies, I guess, right?
Boy, I sure hope you go as hard on some of these other departments. Because fire, to me, is we're talking about the city values, and that is like number one on every check. Have you looked at the city values?
The city values are right there.
I want to start with the five-person shift. Is not just the two in, two out, it's also the fuel calls that we get
two calls that we can go on one at a time.
Right, there were 193 this last year, right?
I don't know.
That's what Chief Hughes responded to my email.
So we're able to...
Yes, thankfully you did. Just didn't get your email.
Well, from my perspective, however we look at this, we were charged with closing a deficit.
And there's two ways
to the business cycle, not to change what the city does, but to look for opportunities within what the city already does.
I think this is a great opportunity to review what the city is doing
and to set
us on a course where we don't get to 10 points millage, right? And then run out of money later and say, what do we do now? Because we're on an end-ending cycle of spending money. And we need to, at some point, slow that down, I think, and reduce some of the things that we spent the last 14 years supporting a large fire department. Can we support, do the next 5 years with maybe a smaller one and see how it goes? I mean.
Yeah, just to kind of back up what you're saying, I think it's good to challenge your question. That's what we're here for. When I heard the fire department explain, giving their pitch, it didn't seem like under the law we could really make many reductions. That's my interpretation. I get what you're saying, and I think those are difficult conversations we have to have. But to me, it sounded like, if we recommended that to the city council, it probably wouldn't, it may not go very far. I don't know.
From my perspective, I see the fire department, why are they so vigorously trying to defend their jobs? I mean, that email, I erroneously sent the email, and I never should have sent the email out, but one of the reasons I would think I want to file the Sunshine Law is because I didn't grant public access, right? I eliminated public access to that conversation.
including the other committee.
Now, how did the fire department, Chief Hughes, when we came back the next day to resolve that issue, had a point, counterpoint document to my email?
So let me handle the two things.
That represents a vigorous, effort to.
So where you ran afoul of sunshine law was that you engaged in conversation on things that you as a group would be deliberating, and deliberating on, you did that with the group outside of the meeting.
Right.
So that was the issue there.
Right. Preventing public access to the conversation is what I think is what the sunshine law.
Which is why we actually discussed it here when we came back here. If any member of this committee sends us a question or an issue with any of the operational aspects of the department, I'm going to send it to the department head. I'm going to ask them to respond. And that is what Chief Hughes did. And any other question we get like that, you're going to have the same response.
I see.
I would feel that if you put together an outline like you did, that you would want to understand the department head's position on that issue. Because, if you're requesting, the last thing we want to do is give you a big recommendation and then get to council and go, we can't do that because we know, we've gone through a lot. So
what's our
point? That's why they want to make sure that you're aware of, the other issues that you may not have considered when you made that recommendation.
Well, I saw the presentation and I hear what the fire department says, and I guess I have a different opinion. It's too expensive, in my opinion. and the debt, and now we're contemplating moving their offices, right? Because they're not satisfied with the prime location where they're at, I guess. It's for resiliency, right? Because it's more prone to flood. Closer to the river, the dune line's higher, and it all flows that way, so they want to move uphill a little bit.
I want to move uphill.
Goodness sakes.
If that was really not the fire department decision, then the manager decision.
Well, I think that's part of the.
They're managing facilities, and they can't get out from hurricanes or flooding. So we have to move them to a ground where they can, and we have to, when we're looking at a facility and you're making improvements to a facility, it needs to last longer than 20 to 30 years. So it's financially,
it's not a bad idea, but I think we need to fiscally march ahead in a fiscally responsible way, right? And maybe, the fire department many years ago lived next to the one building next to the police department, right? And we're not talking about moving the police department to higher ground, I guess, or are we talking about it moving?
The police department in the flood maps that we have, the police, we're talking about moving public works and fire department to the property on Jackson. The public works department will be built first, and then the fire department will be built in about 5 to 6 years. So the public works building is actually the priority now, not the fire department. The police department has access to Tom Street, which has a higher elevation. So we can't move them all at once because we can't afford that. So the police department will remain there until we find another location later on.
Have any of these departments flooded during the previous ones?
The public works flooded.
So there's a quality of life component to this. It's not just dollars and cents. Many, many people move to the city because they have a fire department, because they have a police department. It's on the front page of, it's on my next page of my insurance. That there's a police department and a fire department very close.
I think that many people don't come to this city also for that same reason.
But why would somebody move to the city? We have A, B, C, D, and E, and then start to say, well, I like my city, but I don't want this anymore. Why don't you just move to another city?
But if we did that, I would have that information, that current survey that I asked for, that survey, that 861-page document that was full of useless information. I got through about the first four, five pages. No, it's done in 2011, so it's already 7 years old. What was the population back then, and what is it now? And how many of those people have changed? And by the way, less than 1,000 people answered that survey.
We have, our
current survey on somebody's Facebook page and get at least 900 responses,
yes.
And we can have at least the same 1,000 people making the decision on whether we came here because of the fire department or we came here because we love our beaches.
One thing that it'd be a good idea, just to give you an example, every year Satellite Beach has a valuation increase, just like every other city does. And Satellite Beach's valuation increases at a higher rate than any other beach or any other.
Right.
Some of the other indicators is we have lost a lot of base population in the beach side, but our city has maintained a population and actually grew about 200 people in the past 5 years. The city gets consistently rated for one of the safest cities by numerous organizations all the time. We post that on the Facebook page. So I think from an indicator standpoint, we don't really have a problem attracting people here. So in fact, most of our houses are off the market in hours.
Well, we're residential, but what about commercial development? What about the commercial sector along A1A, commercial along South Patrick?
We have a realtor to talk to us about what's attracting people here.
I mean, I've talked to people low these many years, and I think the combination of zoning, police presence, and fire inspections has driven a lot of business out of this city.
If I had ever been told that, I haven't. When I first started here, I had a lot of complaints on code enforcement, so we stopped for lack of code enforcement completely. In fact, we never rehired a code enforcement officer when we got that position. In City Hall, our positions went down at least 5 people since I've been here. The only position I've hired since I've been city manager has been in public works. So we've done a lot to try to, change our permitting process. We do the staff programs, we went through some, a 3 month permitting process, 30 building to 2 weeks in permitting process time in the past 5 years. So those are things that I heard was code enforcement and building permitting was a problem. But in terms of, I've never had anybody walk up and tell me we have too much police ever. In fact, I've had people ask for more.
And are you harping on expenses and we're stuck on it? And I see from the presentations we've had, we haven't had them all. I'm seeing a minimum of budgeting. I'm not seeing giant increases in spending because we want to acquire and do all this other stuff. But there are two key factors that are involved in this. We have hurricanes that blew the deficit. So one suggestion is, can we have hurricane prepared budgets for our departments that incur expenses during that, so that we're approaching it not as a meter is running, but this is our budget for a storm and how we're managing against it kind of thing, to help address the costs that we incur for that, because that's the other thing. And then it's the, forgive me for the incorrect term, but the exemptions that are reducing revenue that's coming in. Mm-hmm. So those are the factors that are creating the hole that we're in, not that we're having departments that are spending like nuts to do kind of things. So you've reiterated your expense issues, and it's getting us nowhere at the moment. And I just would like to, we've got packets. I'd like to understand how we can get through it so that we have other alternatives. You're entitled to your opinion. I'm not trying to change it, but I feel like it's giving us a stalemate at the moment.
I would like to ask this whole question in a different way. I want to size the problem. On average, and I know you have some of this in the background, but I don't know if you have this specific answer. At 8.4, what is the average city tax, if you will? And at 9.0, what is the average city tax? How much are we talking about? I'd like to size the issue. Are we talking about thousands of dollars per household?
Yes.
How much are we talking about?
So on an 8.4, on average, right, it would be additionally $40 a year.
Okay, now what about at 9.0?
To be honest with you, I haven't done it at 9.0. I have done it at 8.8, which is very close.
I'm just trying to get it.
An average is $100 a year.
$100 a year. So we're talking about $8 a month, $8.50 a month. That's what this whole conversation is about.
Well, but I would also, I mean, the committee was put together, I think, to take a look at all the budgets, like Mr. Schler is questioning. So, you know, to that I agree, but, you know, I haven't seen a lot of opportunity, as you said, you know, so far.
Agreed.
Unless you want to reduce the service, I have to say that. If you want to reduce the service, that option there. So you can say, you know, we don't want to comply with OSHA standards in the fire department, and we don't want to respond to dual medical calls. You know, I hope you're not the one that is on the second line.
I don't disagree with you, but I don't think that was our scope. For this particular, I apologize. Sometimes I can't shut up, I know that. For this particular issue, we were supposed to be able to close the gap of about $600,000. We were supposed to find ways. That was the scope of this committee. Beyond that, we were hoping to go back to Courtney and get approval to have an ongoing budget committee that'll take a look at these things on a longer term basis.
Could I just say that was supposed to also include out-of-the-box ideas on new sources of revenue?
Absolutely.
Which I haven't heard anybody come up with, and I don't know, I looked at that idea list and I didn't see anything other than enforcing speeding tickets, like who, never mind, it doesn't matter who. It's just like,
okay, let's enforce the laws that we already have.
I mean, we're talking about new, out-of-the-box ideas, and when do we get to that part?
I guess I just looked at this as an opportunity to
slash the fire department.
Get in, well, reduce some of our spending instead of just raising revenue.
But it inherent in that is an assumption that there's money being wasted in the department. And most of the people here,
I guess I'm just mentioning the meeting and the level of services that we're paying for, and what's the risk if we cut them, I guess is the question I'm asking, to fall more in line with the cities around us.
We
just cut out recreation. We don't need recreation at all then, okay?
Seems to turn a profit a little bit.
We're not supposed to turn a profit.
Well, actually,
period.
And the city clerk's office has all their legal compliance for the whole city with three employees.
This table right here, I had them put together because this is, this kind of reiterates the difference between satellite beaches compared to the neighboring cities. The, you know, this is one of the issues that we have. We have a lot of recreational facilities. There is no recreation facility that turns a profit. Everything is a cost. I was on the phone with in the Atlantic the other day because they're talking about a dog park over there, and they asked, is it really cost free? And I said, there's nothing that's cost free. Everything has a maintenance cost. If you staff it, it has a staffing cost. It has lighting. It has irrigation. The dog park itself, we resaw it every 3 to 4 years. Everything has a cost. So, you know, when we talk about cutting things, we don't have in our budget, and this is, you know, a common misconception that we can reduce, like, publications and things like that, and that's going to close our budget gap. That's not going to do that. What's going to do that is a major service reduction or closing a facility. That's what's going to close the $600,000 gap. So these are some of the facilities that we have that when you're looking at our hurricane expenses and you think, you know, what's the damage to the buildings and the roads and bridges and things like that, well, that's because we have 16 crossovers in Satellite Beach. Indian Harbor Beach has 3. Okay, so
how many of our crossovers have parking?
I think it's 8, right?
Count at least 6 real quick, I think.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Yeah.
9.
I forgot Shell's name.
So those are the, you know, the benefits of living here, but that comes to the cost, you know. And we also have, a Schechter Center, a community center that nobody has anything close outside the facility here in the east side, which, you know, the air conditioner costs $265,000 to replace. The roof costs $300,000 to replace. So, you know, those are the things that you have to
I would love to spend more money on those kinds of things.
I would like to more improve parking, I want river access, right, I want a dock, I want all these things. I want commercial development, I want it to be fun and exciting around here. But I'm saddled with debt on fire trucks, I'm saddled with debt for bad mismanagement of CRA funds, and I'm saddled with almost $3 million in personnel costs, right? There's it's 1.2 and 9 or something, I don't know, right? It's not 3 million, but it's less, but. So how can I do that? How can I improve my recreational possibilities and improve parking access and ability and have festivals, some of the other ideas we got on here? If I'm forced to pay all these interest payments on everything, pay down all this debt, replenish all these funds that I don't know what we're doing with the money, and pay all these costs and support all these people.
I agree. I walked in here with zero money in reserves and fire trucks that were breaking down on the way to calls and police cars that were on, you know, mechanic shops happened more than they were on the road. I feel you, you know,
I come out in the mornings and I see sometimes that brand new metallic gray Ford Fusion with the vinyl lettering on the side that says citizens volunteer or whatever.
That was a purchase through a donation through a resident.
So somebody funded that and bought a city new car.
That somebody donated $100,000 to the police volunteer program.
And we spent it on a new car.
To the police volunteer program.
We spent it on a volunteer item.
When people donate to your program, that's what you have to spend the money
right,
on.
Right.
So you can't spend it on what you want.
But I want to spend money on improved facilities. I want to spend money on access. I want to spend money on bringing excitement and restaurants and things to this city so I don't have to leave the city to go, you know, get entertained. And I don't see fiscally how we're going to get there because we're buying electric cars for electric chargers and solar panels and we're moving offices around and everything. And I thought that this was an opportunity to get involved, to propose recommendations to the council on what to do with the budget. And so one of my recommendations is let's keep the tax rate where it is for right now. And let's put ourselves on focus of how we start reducing services maybe to a more acceptable level so that we can fund.
Okay, everything you mentioned that you know we're purchasing is all capital purchases.
So either we
buy a gas car and pay for gas, or we buy an electric car and pay for the electricity. It's pretty much the same, except one doesn't pollute and the other one does.
Well, every car has insurance costs,
yeah.
Right?
Maintenance
costs, and all right. So I think we have too many cars. I think we have too many cars. Based on the fact that somebody provided me a list of all the city vehicles, right? And it's 4 pages long.
Wait a minute, but
what part of the service is that? If you see that extra, like what car do you see not needed, and what's that?
You see a lot of cars, but
what do we do? I know some people, I guess, are admitted that they're commuting in their vehicles, right? And I'm kind of against me paying for a city employee to commute.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I thought the deputy fire assistant, he chief.
At one time, the fire chief said he, in the past, he had commuted.
But
when do we get to move on for future?
No, I think we want to get down here, but I think there's too many police here, right? And so there's so many police cars, there's new chargers and stuff.
Based on living here
for my whole life, talking to people about my city and talking to people as I walk around the city, you know, and to some extent, in the mornings when I used to walk my dog, I would run into people and I would say, hey, lately I'm on this committee. You know, what do you think about the services that we have here and how much do we pay in taxes and does that worry you at all? And I have to say that largely people are blissfully ignorant, I guess maybe is the right way to say it or something, but I don't run into a lot of people who even know what their tax bills say, which I'm amazed at. People don't know how to do that.
I don't have any focuses on that because it's not a big line item in their lives.
Well, for me, it's a big line item because I'm heavily invested in this city, and
I don't get all these exemptions. I own a lot of property in this city, and so all of these taxes.
Okay, so this is based on your personal need to get these numbers down so that you don't get hit with a lot of property.
Well, it's on my personal desire to see this city grow and prosper into the future and live up to some utopian ideal, I guess I have, of that where people come here and we have fun things going on, there's good places to eat, right, and there's entertainment facilities and things.
And there's fire protection and security for all of those things.
But no fire trucks and no vehicles.
There's, you know, and this thing about community health, I said, maybe that is the trend. Maybe it is a good trend, but that's a different mission than fire suppression. And so the two in, two out rule that I'm staffing for, maybe, do I need that in paramedics or do I need that in fire people? I want to understand this better because I think I'm spending too much money for services that I'm not really utilizing and are not benefiting the environment around where I'm trying to live. I guess am I communicating or am I just?
I mean, I think it would be helpful to understand where in the police department, so we would just want one person patrolling all the time. Right now, we have enough police officers to have two persons per shift. That's really what we have. So,
I'm sorry to interrupt, but is that why they're separately in their vehicles?
Yes.
So that instead of two
yeah, we don't
people in one car?
Okay.
I have so that was a question I had.
Two Chargers and a Ford Explorer sitting in front of my house for an hour and a half.
And they were helping each other in the hall. Because it's very, we have two people on shift in the police department, plus a supervisor, in dispatch. Because you'd be amazed at how many calls they would go into your presentation from at night. When I started with the city, I thought, I came from high school, which, trust me, that's a whole different world. And so when I started, I thought, wow, we got a pretty nice police department is going to, it's more of a fun department than anything else, but you real quickly realize how much they really do, especially in the middle of the night, and especially on domestic calls. So if we wanted to cut some of that service, we have to say, okay, we're willing to take that risk and go down to one, so you only have one police officer available during the shift. And then that also impacts their safety, too, because there's only one person there. So that's one aspect of that. On the fire side, I already answered that most of the reason why we have four persons of staff per shift is for the purpose of field calls, as well as responding to a major heart attack. They usually use four paramedics in that situation, and one person rides with the county to the hospital. And so most people use these services at different aspects of their lifespan. So you may, as a younger person, may not be using this service right now very often. But if you speak to someone who's about 75 or 80, they use these services quite a bit. So
I know someone who has a key thing and is registered with
the department. I would like to hear her finish. Please stop interrupting her.
So when you talk to, for example, a parent who has their kids in school, they're probably their most important services are going to be recreation, because that's what they use all the time. You go to the shelter center all the time. You go to, you talk to so many older libraries, fire service, that's what they use all the time. I very rarely, I have to say, and I've been doing local government for 20 years now, I have been through probably bigger budget cuts than we are ever considering now in the shuttle program died in Titusville. And at the same time for their suffering. So the idea of cutting public safety is very hard on council members to think about now, to be honest with you on that. So those are some of the things that you have to think of. When you talk about cutting those services, we would have to put together that analysis of what that impact would be to the community. So if you have two people on shift, you may get to a call, one call in 4 minutes, but you're going to have to wait for the county in a second. And then you're going to have to get there until, for 15 minutes. And in a heart attack, that's basically life change. So that's the service impact that you have to deal with. And that's something that they all think about when they're making decisions.
Thank you. I think there are also environmental aspects. Many, many kids, little kids, walk to school or take their bike, and that's because the city is safe. If you change those dynamics and they're not safe, then that whole paradigm changes, and that's a quality of life issue for Saddle Lake Beach. I mean, I live on the corner of Diane and I's house. We tell all the neighbors we're in a safe house. Depending on what ever happens, the kids go right to my house, and we immediately call the parents. Because we're right on the corner there where everybody turns, all the kids. And we don't have those issues because everybody here is in a good place in terms of security and safety. And that's health and safety of an environment. I think those things are really important. And for me, I'm willing to pay for that. Even though I don't have any little children, I love the fact that they go to school every day. You don't have to worry. It's just perfect.
Would we be less safe if we only had one police officer roaming our
It's a, please don't worry. It's really bothering me.
Well, we're doing a budget exercise here. Of course I'm cost analyzing everything.
No,
that's what we're supposed to be doing,
okay,
right? Otherwise, let's just raise the millage rate and keep spending what we're getting.
I don't deserve that.
I'm sorry.
Can we have off for a minute? So can Suzanne, can you just tell us, this particular meeting, I believe, was for brainstorming, government. So again, I think it's healthy to have debates about our costs. Now, I've learned a lot throughout this process, and I'm probably leaning toward, I'm going to be okay with raising the millage rate, but I think it's good to still debate it. Is that what this evening is intended for?
Do you like us to do, the police are starting?
Yes, next week.
Would you like us to have them give you an estimate of what it would be? Impact, service impact, or going down to do something, and they can do that. That's the stuff that, if you want us to do those analyses, that's what we're here for, and that's what we're
doing. I don't really have an objective analysis with it, right?
Yeah, and again, I don't know how much power this committee has, but again, we don't want to just go through the motion if, even if we did, you probably wouldn't win in a vote of the panel based on, the conversation. So why go through the exercise of doing
that? Yeah, we want to vote to tell us to do that,
So that's just kind of what I'm asking. I think it's healthy debate to talk about all of our expenses, but again, I don't know what else we're going to go through in this packet, and maybe that'll drive more conversation, but I for one think it's good to debate all of our costs.
There's no question that debate is good, but one of the things that we try to do is the whole budget process is based on the values that we place on the city. You strip away those values, we can get rid of police, we can get fire, we can get rid of half of our staff. But then we have to live with the consequences of that. We're going to have a very low tax rate.
Right.
What are you willing to pay for what? What do you get for what? What is the quality? What is the value proposition for how much you're paying and what are you getting for it? In a group society, in a broad society, certain segments pay like everybody else and they don't get as much out of it, and others pay the same rate and get a lot out of it. That's part of community living. If you want to do something specifically on what you do, you need to the country with somebody around you, and you just pay the taxes for your little life, and you're done.
Yeah, and all
that's
I'm saying.
That's all I'm saying.
Embrace the diversity of thought, and that's all I'm saying. But also,
there is a diversity. That's the problem I have. Is I hear one person's opinion trying to be expounded upon, and it's always the same person every time. I don't hear a diversity of thought. I hear other people that aren't on board with that one train of thought, and I don't hear any other trains of thought even going out there. So correct me if I'm wrong, but I get what your position is. Now I'd like to hear somebody else.
I think the other committee members are saying, we're probably on the side of being willing to increase the millage rate. But again, when the fire chief was here, he said he thanked Mr. Schler for asking difficult questions because it makes him do his job better.
And that's what I'm saying. every year. And we, so we will have, we have no problem staring at the department heads and saying, you're not supposed to do that this year. That's not something we have a problem with. You will see department heads passionately defend their department, because that's their passion, it's their job, and they're very proud of it. So you'll always see that, you know, you're never gonna see them dispassionately say, sure, I'll let it out by myself. I mean, they're not gonna do that. So you'll always see that, you know, you're not gonna get an objective answer from them. But from us three, we will be glad to provide any information like that for you.
I guess just to sort of bring back a little bit to where we left off, you guys are all right. I mean, the point of this first meeting here, where we have freedom of discussion, is to share all the ideas, you know, to pro and con it as much as we need to, because ultimately what we're looking for, as I think we already mentioned, is, you know, votes that lead to recommendations, that lead to a final report that we then take to council, to wherever that leads us. But we have, you know, in addition to today's meeting, next week when we get together, we're going to have community development, police. We, as we know, when we do the presentations, we don't have a whole lot of time for discussion. So that's why we didn't add in the June 19th meeting. So we're going to have the June 19th and the June 28th meetings, two additional meetings beyond this one. So this is really, for me, an important first meeting for us to really just hear each other out, flesh it out, talk about stuff, you know, really get some sense of where we're going, so that when we get to the next two more brainstorming type meetings, hopefully we'll get some more traction and get something officially moved forward from the final report. At least that's my hope out of all this discussion.
I think that's right. Still, I asked the size of the problem. And we're talking about $8 a month per household. Mm-hmm. We're spending an awful lot of time and effort and energy trying to figure out $8 a household. I'm sorry, but I don't care what business you're in, I don't care what you do for a living, costs go up every year. Okay? They just do. People have to get call raises, they have to get performance raises, electricity costs go up, everything goes up. I mean, you just look at the CPI. Every year things go up just a little bit. And so if we were on a standard run rate, that's what one of the things I tried to ask for is, what would a normal run rate be of absolute expenses in the city? Then you can take your 2% or 3% in and every year be very comfortable. But right now, we have things that collapse overnight. And when you put it off, the propensity of that happening next year are even greater. So all we're doing is debt spiraling by looking internally and trying to get rid of things in order to fund that. That doesn't make any sense. That is a dying philosophy. This is a long-term process. We have to budget over.
And I agree, but you see, we raise the value of the property, that increases our revenue, right? So we need to find a way to raise the value of all of our property. And our city manager has suggested that, well, our property rates, our assessments are going up, and they're going up faster than the cities around us, I guess, right? But how do we really raise that up? How do you add value to what we have here?
Because the
without increasing millage on existing tax base, let's increase the value and keep the millage rate low, the revenue still goes up. So there's two ways to approach this.
Yeah, but the market drives your values. You can't predetermine.
It's a perception and reputation, and it's something that we've also discussed here. It's in our values and risk analysis.
Exactly. Right? Exactly.
So when you talk to people, what is the reputation of this city? And I have said, when I talk to people, the reputation is it's heavy on beliefs. It's heavy on beliefs, right? And I don't speed when I come in that city, and I certainly don't drink in that city, right?
You can't.
I'm not disagreeing that people say that.
I've heard that forever.
I mean, so, all right, so what ideas do you have, Millie? I mean, we have a whole set of ideas here on how to raise rates, right? And only one.
Can I make a suggestion that we don't make this personal to anyone?
No, I'm not.
If this is an issue, put it on the table. No, it's an issue.
That's what I'm saying. She wants to. Okay.
You know, we do need to try to have one person talk at a time.
You are something else, man.
Hey.
Okay.
Really? Sure.
So let's.
Yeah. Can I make just one suggestion real quick? So, if we want to talk about raising property values, most cities that are able to lower their millage rate every year have the benefit of new construction. We do not have that benefit to the level that you need that benefit. So making this, some of these years not so horrible, it's not covering that $600,000 gap. Places like West Melbourne and Cocoa Beach aren't crying about the $25,000 homestead exemption because they have A, new construction over at West Melbourne, or B, 25% homestead exemption, not 80 like we do. So they don't care very much. So we are in that position of being a revenue community that's almost built out. So we rely primarily on just the increase of existing valuations, where West Melbourne, Palm Bay, other places that do well, rely on good, big new construction projects that we just don't have. So that's where you know, some of the problems of being a veteran community come in. So to answer your question, to get that money coming in without raising the millage rate is new construction. The flip side of that is you run into the people, which we're running into now, that don't want to see the community change with new construction. And the idea of, you know, attracting bigger buildings and so on is important to a lot of people, and they're afraid of that type of change. So that's the kind of the, you know, things that the council has to weigh. You know, I love to see new construction because I get to see that, you know, revenue increase. But I grew up here, so seeing those Oceana condominiums when I drive by, I'm like,
Yeah, make a couple of comments there, I guess. What about all the property that we got from Patrick Air Force Base? Isn't that acreage that's planned to be upscale housing or something, right?
So the area where you see the Montecito new construction,
right,
the townhomes, that's not a very big project. So it'll be a little bump in revenue, like maybe 30,000
or 40,000.
But it's not like, you know, a big subdivision like what West Melbourne gets. You know, and have like 500 units a year. But the between the Montecito and A1A on the north side of Shearwater, that's a 27-acre parcel. Those property owners purchase that property, they're demolishing the units that are there, and they will start site planning that project. We will probably maybe see that revenue in 5 years if they develop that. The 100 acres, which is the vacant area, that is under an agreement with Patrick Air Force Base for 50 years. So, well, okay, I guess it's like 40 now, right?
What ratio will you assessing?
So unless the base releases that hold on that, because it's supposed to be the military housing, unless the base says we don't need that anymore, it's going to sit there like that until they trigger military housing.
So the other part
and military housing, by the way,
right,
is half of it.
Also, the other part of that is then is the spending, right? So our population is not growing, we're built out, and the revenue is not going up. The assessed values are not going up very rapidly. So why do we keep hiring people and spending more money on increasing service levels? Why don't we fiscally say, oh, well, here's a budget, let's live within the budget, and save a little money for impending storm events or something?
So the hiring people, we have hired public works people, and we have yet to get to the place where we were back in 2007 in terms of hiring. So they're the only people that we've hired. We hired an environmental coordinator that offset the other four people that I let go when city hall members were starting.
Right, well, those people
so
are
we are actually less staff than we were before, and it's 5 years ago.
Why are we hiring people for a couple of words?
Because they're drastically understaffed.
Because what?
They're understaffed.
Well, so because they have more work to do, right? We have people to do it, right? Yeah. And part of the reason for that is because we've allowed things to deteriorate, so they have more to do.
Well,
that's why the money gets caught up somehow, some way, with a financial plan, so that we understand the run rate and maintain what we have in a proper way, so that we actually know what expenses ought to be. When you're in a hole like this, it is so difficult to figure out how to
get. Just to give you an idea, like, we're doing the DeSoto Stormwater Pond coming up, that's construction's coming up. So we could build that pond and put a fence around it and let the weeds grow like a FDOT pond, you know, with stormwater. We could do that, right? But we wouldn't. But we're a satellite beach, so we don't, and we're, you know, people pay tax So we're putting a sidewalk around it, landscaping, a kayak launch at the soda pond. It's a pretty high-tech stormwater pond, which protects the manatees that are in there, which we had to do. So we have a lot of state mandates. That entire project is a state mandate because of water quality. So we have to clean our stormwater. All of those things are new. So yes, the stormwater fund will pay for that, that pond to construct it, but we have to maintain it. We have to maintain grass. We have to mow it. We have to maintain the sidewalk. We have to maintain the lights.
The shovel.
And we need 10 mowers to do that.
So we have a lot of mowers. We have a lot of things to mow. Have you ever seen how many fields we have?
Or just such a small land.
Can you imagine doing that in summer? We have three soccer fields, a football field, four, how many baseball fields? Five baseball fields.
Softball fields, I forget.
Pelican Beach Park, Cassia, Roosevelt, DeSoto. I mean, it goes on and on. The South Pocket Drive. So, you know, every week we have to mow all of that. So yeah, we have a lot of mowers for that reason. I mean, if people didn't want us to mow during the recession, we put mow, we went to what, twice a week? And oh, we tried to, yeah, remember? And everybody went nuts. So we went back to, you know, so, you know, when we say things like, we have a lot, we need a lot of those mowers, we wouldn't have them if we didn't. We don't just buy stuff because we just feel like it. We buy it because we need it. You know, we bought two fire trucks because we need them. You know, I don't want to spend money on fire trucks, but I don't need to. I mean, that's ridiculous. We don't do that here. I mean, nobody does that. You know, we just buy stuff for no reason.
Of anything, whether it's dollars or machinery or equipment, has to be put in their context. Just because you have 10 of something or 20 or something, you have to understand what it's needed for, and then if you can pull some excess capacity out of that, that's what you need.
But that's why I wanted you to see this. You know, this impacts maintenance so much in the capital assets fund. It impacts our operating fund to a huge degree in public works. And that's why, you know, when we build a facility like Pelican Beach Park, is a huge, we have a person there all day long every day doing maintenance there all day long every day. So, you know, when we have facilities like that and we build things, the cost, ongoing cost of that is forever and it will always go up. So DeSoto Pond, it's going to be pretty. It will clean the water. It's treating 400 acres. It's a state mandate. We have to do it. I mean, you know, that's a requirement. But we have to maintain it, and that's going to be an added cost to the city from now on after we build that.
So it's a good time for a break,
yeah.
And then maybe when we come back, we can move this in a little bit more.
Okay. Pick up where we left off. Thank you. Yes, ready. Ready. You good?
Yeah.
Okay. So, back to the spreadsheets, if you don't mind.
Mm-hmm.
So now I am four pages flipped inward to the one that is titled Staff Recommendation. So,
wait, how many pages?
Four.
Should say staff recommendation.
I'm sorry. If you turn three pages, you get the four.
Oh, this one.
All right. So what we've done is because we feel really comfortable now with our knowing what our expenditures will be for 18-19, and we obviously know what the impact of the additional $25,000 homestead exemption will be the year after that, assuming that passes in November, which we all can pretty much count on at this point. Because we feel comfortable with those numbers, are now we decide to go ahead and create what we would recommend in terms of the millage rates, all expenditures, all operational parameters being the same as they are at this moment in time, not adding new positions other than the two required school resource officers, and trying to do what we felt was a reasonable recommendation to get us to a place where we're putting enough money into capital assets that we can significantly and comfortably fund our infrastructure needs,
and putting enough money back into reserve so that we can feel comfortable that we are prepared or more prepared than we are today for a hurricane, and at the end of the 5 years be where we should be from a hurricane preparedness standpoint. That's what I'll explain a little more in a second. That's what this model is all about. This is trying to rebuild reserves, have extra for the hurricanes, meet all of the current expenditures that we know are coming up next year, and you know, based on the projections for the increases in expenditures going forward, just you know, 2% and things like that. That's what this model reflects. And so, let me just walk through it real quick with you. So, this proposes starting in 18-19 next year to take our current rates to an 8.691. This is the last year before the homestead exemption would affect us. So if we take 8.691, we plug that in as our millage rate. If you go down to the line that says fund balance reserves, and you look at net position at 8.691, you'll see that our reserves at the end of 18-19 are $681,000.
Provided there's no significant event.
Correct. So,
but that's with the $100,000
hurricane. I was just going to add that, yes. So the other thing is we added in a dedicated hurricane line item just for $100,000. Obviously, we'd like to be more, but we felt comfortable recommending this within this millage rate scenario. Extra $100,000 in expenses. If it's not spent, it's just dropping back into reserves for the next year and it builds. So hypothetically, that 681, if we didn't have any storms, it would be 781 at the end of that year. That's what that means. Then what we recommended for 1920 is to increase the millage rate to 8.8212, the year that the homestead exemption takes effect. And again, if you stay down there below that fund balance reserve line, the bottom line for us net position is that in 1920 will be about $821,000 in reserves, plus the $100,000 that we've set aside in expenditures for hurricanes if we don't have a hurricane. So that would be an extra for that. And as you go along, you'll see that at the end of the 5 years, we're at $1.1 million in reserves. Again, no hurricanes. So what we tried to do was find a rate, keeping everything the same, that would make us more comfortable about funding capital assets and rebuilding reserves for hurricane preparedness. Now, if you ask me, is this my ideal, maximum, most wonderful plan? No, I mean, because I'd like to have, you know, millions of dollars in reserves today.
Sure.
But I can't do that realistically, so this is our latest proposal that we feel comfortably gets us to that point. You can see in the capital asset transfer line, a little bit above that reserve line, where we're putting money back into reserves. We started a little slow the first couple, back into capital assets. We started out slow the first couple of years, but then by 2021, we're trying to put $500,000 into our infrastructure capital assets for all those subsequent years. This is what we would, yes.
8.691 and 8.8212 per household per year is what increase?
Well, I can tell you the 8.8 is $100. So
okay.
So the 8.6 would be, 8.4 was 40, so 8.8 is 100. So,
okay.
Give me an idea.
So it's like 50, 60.
Like
the interim step.
Right.
That's per year.
And correct.
Homestead property.
Yeah. Compared to today's
investment property.
Right.
Yeah. This is pretty much average of a single family home.
Yep.
So.
We could do a sample of commercial investment property too, to see if you see that.
Yeah. We have it. I mean, we originally had put that together. So, I mean, the information is there. Yes. So the information is there. It just becomes a little difficult because obviously every house is valued differently. So if you wanted to look at yours specifically, we could do that. It's not hard. So.
Other questions on this? I mean, I just gave you the quick high level, but.
Do you all know how to figure out your knowledge? And your property tax rate? So you would take your assessed value after exemption. And multiply it by this millage rate times 1,000. So
divided by
1,000. So you take the millage rate with 0.0
Yeah, if you're gonna put the point zero zero, then you don't have to divide it by five.
I need the point zero zero.
It's easier, yeah, so, but you do have to take your assessed value, because, you know, you have a assessed value, and then you have, or you have the taxable value, and you have the assessed value, and the difference normally is whether or not you have a homestead exemption of some stripe, so you have to make sure that you take the assessed value.
Not the taxable value, not your exemption, and multiply, so this 8.691 would be, you multiply your assessed value by 0.008691, and that would be your tax rate.
So, if I'm reading this correctly, in 1819, the reserve goal should be 1.6 million.
Correct.
But we're only gonna have six. So we're short $1 million.
Yes.
If everything stays constant above these lines, then it starts to shrink. The delta starts to, it shrinks over time. Not a very happy rate, but it does shrink. My question to Courtney is, well, I'm not sure it's a question to you, Courtney, because again, it's a question of what do you think you will need for reserves during this period.
So when we talk about like the reserve goal, as Christopher said, that's a standard that we use, so we
sure
start it. In reality, most city managers want to have twice that amount. So you'll see, like, we won't stop at 1.8, you'll see it. You know, and the reason why is you just saw what happened with, you know, one season, one hurricane season. You know, that was $700,000 just for one hurricane. So I feel comfortable. It's a gamble, it is, with the 681. And really the gamble is that if we go into a hurricane and we use that, the concern would be cash flow later on in the year. That would be the concern. So that's a gamble. Once we get to 821, we get a little bit better, but we'll be best in 2021.
This is what I would call a business risk assessment. And how much business risk are you willing to accept?
And I mean that
most sincerely, because this is a very, very difficult thing to deal with it alone. Other than we know we have not had a hurricane here. The last one is not really considered a hurricane that we had at Satellite Beach. The question is, what happens if we have a tooth that actually hits Satellite? By the time it hit Satellite, it was just a very bad tropical storm. What happens if we have a tooth? What becomes the damage level? Does it stay the same or does it get worse? In a lot of conversations, we've made assumptions that as you go up the scale of hurricanes, the damage to them gets worse. I don't know if that's actually true.
Is there some sort of forecast model that you're using that we can just say there's a lump sum of money that we're going to allocate towards, you know, $300,000, what does it cost to cover a storm? $200,000,
$300,000, $400,000? Well, my point to your point is I think if you have a one, it's probably between $300,000 and $400,000. If you have a two, probably $600,000 to $700,000, and so on and so forth.
So you're going by hurricane.
So now you got to go by probability. Okay. The forecast for this year is supposed to be a lot worse than last year. I don't know what you do with that.
And that's the gamble when you don't have, you know, a good reserve pile. When we started in 2013, I had $50,000 in reserve.
You had what?
$50,000.
Wow.
Right
now?
No, when I started.
Oh, yeah,
I know. So we, you know, but we had
big survives. 5 more years.
Oh my goodness. We built reserves very fast though. What we did was we went to the county and negotiated with the county to basically stop CRA projects and move money from CRA over into the general fund.
Right.
So that's what we did. We didn't survive that by sitting around doing that. So that's another, we need about a million in the bank between all the funds to deal with cash flow. Right, is that a good assessment?
Good assessment, okay.
Just because of timing issues.
Yeah, because money, you know, you
money doesn't flow in.
It always doesn't pop up in the bank account in one day, so it comes in over the year. So, you know, if you don't have money to deal with payments, you know, and you can't, you gotta make payroll, and you've gotta pay your bills, and so if you don't have that money sitting there,
So you said to smooth the numbers.
Right, so there's two ways to approach that. That's a budget, right? You either reduce your costs or raise your revenue.
Right, I mean, that's, and then when you said fiscally responsible, I hear that all that, that's what we do. But I have to take a little bit of issue with that, because we wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for two hurricanes and homestead exemption. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here talking to you about this problem, because it would be a problem. We wouldn't have a problem. So, you know, the issue isn't that we're being financially irresponsible. The issue is that we've had outside influences affecting the budget that we need help with in deciding whether we're going to reduce costs or raise revenue or a combination thereof. You know? So, I don't know if that's considered being more fiscally responsible or just addressing the problem. You know, when we say things like we need to be more fiscally responsible, it makes it sound as though we were errors in spending money before. And you know, I'm not sure.
Well, may I make a comment, I guess? Because you say we lost the CRA, right? That was our redevelopment fund. And because of, I think, mismanagement.
We didn't use the CRA. We made a conscious decision.
Well, we got rid of it, right? because we ran into trouble with it. And we ended up with a lot of debt from it. And so it was easier, I guess, to just close down all the projects and just shift the money to something that was more helpful. It seems to me like that whole CRA thing was not managed very well. So I would say that was not
the CRA thing was a club political football for a group of people that wanted to become elected. So sometimes that happens where they'll find an issue, and CRAs countywide have been an issue that people like to grab onto. It's hard to understand. So they grabbed on that issue, and they made an issue about how the city spent some of the CRA money. I did respond to that. I managed CRAs. I served on the Florida Redevelopment Association Board. I testified in court cases as a CRA expert. So I think I know a little bit about them, and I didn't. The only thing I saw that the city did incorrectly was the fire expenditures, which were so minor. Everything else was done according to statute. If people felt that they spent them, they should have spent them differently. That's different than mismanagement, you know. So sometimes people make choices in the past. Like I probably wouldn't have done some of the things because it's not something I thought would be important to do. But at the time, that's what they felt was important. I wouldn't call it mismanagement, though. I would say they just made a different choice that I agree with. So that's a different way, you know, saying it.
That's true, and I guess there were just some things that I disagreed with.
Right.
So the results. But I feel kind of bitter about it now, because now we've lost that CRA fund, CRA thing altogether, and there's debt remaining behind it. And so that...
Well, what we did was we decided to just quit the project, because when you're looking at the city of Satellite Beach, we're renovating the Civic Center with the CRA fund. We did A1A. We're going to be following up with the streetscape of the agents, you know. But once we were done with that, what else are we going to do? I mean, so what other streetscape projects do you all see? I mean, we're thinking about doing Jackson, but we're not even close to being, you know, near.
Well, I look at just the corner of Cassia Boulevard right here, right? There's a beach access there, and we put in this nice, swoopy sidewalk over the ditch that was there forever, which I,
was
kind of nice, right? But then it ended, right? And it actually ended at my property, some of the paving of the road and stuff, I guess, next zone, I guess, or whatever, but you still can't get across A1A.
That's the commercial property.
Because you can't, the sidewalk ends, and then you have to go in a turn lane if you're on a bike or walking or something, or then across parking blocks or whatever, so why don't we finish that?
Because the property owner at that point, we didn't want to worry.
And then that.
So anyway, so what I'm trying to say is, the CRA was a great tool at the time, but it's run its course, so we don't need it anymore. And it's expensive on the general fund side to hold it, because it doesn't do anything, but a CRA doesn't make more money. It's not an additional tax.
Well, it saves money.
It corrals money into one spot. So what it does, whatever you corral into that spot, takes away from over here. So, you know, we're looking at priorities and being fiscally responsible. The council decided it was more important to fund daily operations without raising taxes than to do special projects with the CRA.
It's funny, we're not here to debate that.
Well, I wonder what are we here to debate, I guess.
We're not here to
argue. You don't know why now.
Well, no, but it's part of the argument of that, I guess, that I'm trying to make about we need to point the ship.
Well, so
maybe in a slightly different direction to get to where we want to go. Where we finish sidewalks, where we do streetscaping, or we improve the environment a bit, as opposed to having to pay salaries or pay for insurance costs or pay debt down for past ills, right? So
the problem is that there is no opposed. You have to pay salaries, you have to pay insurance costs, and you have to pay down debt. There's no getting out of that.
Well,
unless you want to cut service. So that's what you have to decide.
I think that's what's on the table, right? That either we reduce expenditures or we increase revenues. That's what we're here to do, I think. And so I'm just trying to probe. My perspective is, let's cut services a little bit to reduce our expenditures, or let's at least maintain the status quo for a couple of years, right, and not increase our taxes, but try to live within our budget to find maybe if we can continue to maybe reduce some departments or reduce some vehicles or something along, to reduce some of the sustainability projects or whatever we're doing to spend money, you know. It's only $600,000. Is that going to break all of our plans if we don't?
60%
of the total cost of money. And that's, you have to remember,
that's the amount of money
that I have. Right, that's the community development department.
Yeah.
You have to remember that that's just the homestead exemption piece, you know, we're just pulling that right out of the revenue item. We're also trying to overcome the issue with not having, you know, significant, substantial reserves.
Right.
And then we're also trying to put money aside to actually deal with some of the infrastructure needs. So all those kind of together is why it's actually a bigger number. 600,000, but I guess, Andrew, because, you know, we've come back to this again, I hear everything you're saying, and as I said before, the point of this is to have free-flowing conversations, but there's also a point where, as a group, you all have to make a decision collectively, and you're going to have to vote. I know you've already made one motion that didn't move yet.
Right, right.
So there is a scenario in this, and this has happened in other committees, as I understand it, where if you remain convinced that your position is the recommendation that you think the committee should make, but the committee is not with you, or the committee votes and they've made whatever recommendation is, and you're still out there separately, if that's where this ends up, you can certainly, as part of the report, submit, you know, a minority report comment, or, you know, there can be something that is your thoughts that we could include if the group chose to agree that.
I'm okay to be odd man out, but I will help to support everyone else's idea. I mean, I'm not an angry man. I just want to say, for
everybody, really, there is a point in this report that we put together that we can put all kinds of things in this report that are things that maybe the group did not actually end up with the final recommendation. The vote said one thing, but then everybody, there were these other ideas, you know? I mean, we can certainly do that. Just so that you know, we can have that as part of the final, you know?
Okay, thanks.
May I also suggest, again, we talked about this early on, but I'm not sure it's not getting lost. The $600,000 that we have to make up is because there's a tax reduction in everybody's
monthly bill or annual bill. And what we're trying to do is bring that back up to zero. So if you have a new $25,000 deduction, that may be worth $80 a year to you, and we're looking for $80 a year over here. It's not going to raise your taxes. Not in that effect, unless you have certain.
For me, it will, because my assessed value is not more than $175,000 because I have to save our home tax. So the new exemption does not affect me at all.
Andrew.
And all the rest of my property gets no exemption.
I have no doubt that you know your stuff, because obviously you've done a lot of study. But this committee is talking about the broad community, not a specific. And unfortunately for you, it may cost you some more. And I don't mean that in a negative way.
And if that's the net result, then I can accept that, I guess. But so I made a motion at the top of the meeting, and I'll make some more motions, but you know, we need to start the report, I guess.
Okay. Yeah, okay, the preference is the report. Yes, go ahead.
I have a question. Have you looked at a recommendation where the proposed rate for the first year was the 8.8.2, and then the additional years bump in at the next higher rate? Because my question is, I see where you are at fund balance and net positions, but this is, I think, maybe picking up a little bit on Larry's theme. I think you've made some concessions through this in that not everything's been funded. We're doing balances. I applaud the fact that you have a $100,000 dedicated hurricane line item, but if a storm hits, that's a bucket of water to me kind of thing. So I just didn't know if you were in the scenario of another combination and
we only have the 8.8212 for all 5 years straight through. We don't have
okay.
But it's pretty easy. I mean, if you flip to the page before that, that has the 5 millage rate. If we were to go to an 8.212 at the end of fiscal year 18-19, you would have a reserve balance of $789,865. If you were to move it to the 8.9212 for the next following years, at the end of the 5 years, you have probably about 1.
I was going less because you were at an 8.8.
Yeah, so I would say 1. Yeah, about a 1.6 at the end of the 5 years.
Okay.
This won't apply either, but my preference would be instead of $100,000 a year, because that's generally smooth numbers, I'd rather say $500,000 in 18-19 and zeros in the other number in the end of the columns. Not spending more, I'm front loading, because that's how much a hurricane is going to cost. $100,000 is not what a hurricane is going to cost, and we don't have enough compartment for that. Like, that to me is more reality, but it's not.
I understand. Well, it's still there. It's just like in reserves, or it's in that hurricane line item. You know, either way, because we've got $681,000 in the reserves.
But what I'm suggesting is by bumping it up, you have to change the revenue stream for 18-19.
So you're saying maintain that reserve level and increase the hurricane line to $500,000
for that year, okay? And then based on experience, you can readjust the military going forward. You might be able to bring it down.
To put it at $500,000 in 18-19, get the millage rate where it needs to be in order to get to reserves, and then
and see how it drives that millage rate number,
okay.
And see if it's still within the realm of reason.
And if we didn't have a hurricane, then
you can adjust the millage rate next year or increase your reserves on a continual basis. And that would help you smooth out unplanned events going forward.
So what he would be suggesting is to, instead of have $100,000 in that hurricane line item, is to move it to $500,000. And as you do that, you have to get the revenues, because you have to raise the millage rate higher to keep the reserves at $1 million. Is that what I heard? That's what you wanted the reserves to be at the end of 18-19 is $1 million?
I thought we were just keeping it where it was.
Or even at the 681.
Yeah, I was keeping, in my mind, I was just keeping that flat. I was just increasing the expense line. Therefore, you have to increase the revenue line.
Yeah, because you can. I mean,
and then going forward, I mean, for this exercise, you can put zeros in 1920, 2021, 2022.
So I'll give you.
And it'll be a moving scale based on experience.
So you'll be moving that
It's basically like holding a fund balance in your hurricane line item, like rolling it over to the next day, you know, hurricane.
Because the reality is, if you have a, if we have a two in 1819, this doesn't do anything. We're broke. We're done. So we're really not solving a problem.
Well, if we just create a separate fund.
Pardon? Well, we talked about doing, we talked about below the line items from unexpected events that are hard to predict and control. Because your budget process is predicted control future, but this is.
Is the stormwater funds kind of that kind? And if you increase your, they're talking about increasing the utility tax, I think, right? And we have extra money to go onto a storm fund in addition to the stormwater fund.
Well, stormwater is a special fee, it's like highly regulated on how you can spend it. So you can only spend it on stormwater distribution and water quality system. You can't spend it on anything else.
Not on storm response.
Yeah.
That's just a stormwater infrastructure.
So I would like to make another motion. I will make a motion that we put in our report to recommend that the city council does not increase the stormwater utility fee. And leave it as it is right now at $104 per property.
Any seconds?
So, thank you for that. Back to just follow up real quick. So I'm sure I understood what you're saying. If we were to type the $500,000 into a hurricane line item in 1819 and maintain a reserve net position at $681,000, I mean, when I look at the net position at a 9.0 millage rate, that gave us another, it's under $300,000.
Well, that's why I was saying we have to look to see what's reasonable. I just threw that out as a starting point.
Yeah. So I'm just saying, I don't actually think.
Maybe $300,000 is the right number.
Yeah.
So you increase it by $200,000 because that's all we can do. But you want to start with the biggest number you can and then say what's reasonable, what's sellable, and you know, all that kind of stuff. And what's within in the parameters of a village. So maybe that's not the right number. Otherwise, we could do a million and get it over.
Right, and we could, but we couldn't even get there with the 10.
You can't do it. It's outside the parameters. So.
I mean, we're open again to anything you guys want to recommend or tell us, you know, to recommend.
I just put that out for food. I mean, it's another way to look at it.
I guess you're right. I think that where we're at with this proposal, the staff recommendation, even though it's not as aggressive on the rebuilding of the reserves as I would like to see, it's also something that internally we've talked about as being more palatable and doable from a political standpoint, too. Because that's what we're trying to balance, too. I mean, I'm totally fine saying.
Trying to balance Valerie's name.
Yeah.
Somewhere along this line.
It's not personal.
Somewhere along this line is what's called a tipping point.
Yeah. That's
how
we're
going to see what the city council has to address both.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Both sides, so that you know they're looking to us to give them that compromise and that.
I would suggest that we all stand here and agree on everything that everybody says, then we really end up in a committee.
Yeah, that's true.
We have to see opposing ends because that's how you extract the best possible answers. So it's not a bad thing.
Well, I interrupted and said I have looked at X, Y, and Z, and then it opened the door for other opportunities. So let me, excuse my interruption. This is your recommendation because it's a little bit middle of the road. You think it's politically viable. It's balanced. Let's keep going through it. So I understand more.
But if I should add one more thing. When I said the 500,000 and 000, if more reasonable works out, maybe do 300,000, 000. I mean, there's a number of different ways to look at it to make it palatable for all the stakeholders and also be able to respond to an emergency.
Right. So kind of looking at increasing that hurricane line item to be able to more realistic to reality of what you expend in a hurricane,
correct,
but also trying to make sure that you balance.
But then you have to compensate that with a revenue increase.
Okay, so at the end of today, after more discussion, like, just give us some direction. If you want us to actually bring back some scenarios that look like some of these different things, I mean, I'm making notes now, but I can bring back our next meeting, you know, a 500 or 300, whatever is, whatever the math will work out to be. But it'd be good to have sort of a consensus vote of some sort from the group saying this is what we'd like to look at. Yeah.
And I just real quick, when you said we stopped that hurricane line item by department, do you think, like, because we had a hurricane expense line item just generally throughout the whole city, was your intention to do it by department? Because I was kind of thinking it might be helpful just to see what each department is spending.
Yes, because I think in some of it you could control some of the expenses, and that, yes, provide the services where you need them, but could you control some of the overtime?
Right.
Could the debris removal go out a little bit further? Does debris removal include bid processes for the lowest rate, or are we just subject to, you know, somebody's willing to do it and this is the rate and you want to get rid of it, so that's what we're paying. So, yeah.
Okay.
Manage it as a budget.
Yeah.
It's a more effective management approach to that particular event, rather than just having a pot of money on the way to somebody.
I don't think it would be an issue to do that. I mean, it's pretty simple to do. The only challenge would be is probably between recreation and public works, because a lot of times those types of things can cross over a little bit. But
I might get them, the department has
a better idea
on how they're going to respond to that financially rather than just operationally, because that's their primary concern in hurricanes operations. We're the expense bossies. They're more of a.
Yeah, that would be easy enough, because as long as they code it to one single same line item, this hurricane, whatever, in every department, then we can easily pull that for FEMA, so that would be fine.
That would actually probably help us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do you want to make a motion to?
We want to put that in the report, or you just want to see additional scenario? I didn't understand.
No, there was a motion I made earlier to say, do we have or could we make a hurricane budget that departments would manage by budget? Because the components are service expenses and services for removal fees. I heard three big buckets that were roughly,
right,
probably fair.
Public safety, and then. And then afterwards, it's primarily public works. So
overtime, it's debris, it's property.
Property, facility fixes.
From a management perspective, okay, it's easy to put these things up, and then you have to figure out how you're going to manage it. So one of the things I think of is, to your point, is have that line item for extraordinary event, rather than just call it a hurricane. But there needs to be a subsidiary ledger that says this is what's for equipment, this much for people, and so on and so forth. I wouldn't want that embedded in their current line items.
That's interesting.
It needs to be separated, but then they need to budget those line items.
It kind of happens. Yeah, in the computer program, they have, like, if you look up one line item, she can tell you what each of that line item has, includes. So.
Well, this needs to be a tool for the department heads.
Right. Yeah, well, the department heads are the ones that can come up with those.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Yeah, so hurricane overtime. Operational.
I wouldn't want it in there, overtime, normal overtime line.
No, we would keep it separate.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think that's a good idea.
But
that's more like a operational tool, too.
So I'm sorry, what's that motion? I got a little
off. So what exactly would happen?
Does it need to be
one motion?
Let me phrase that as a motion.
Well, are we making or have a recommendation in the that, or whatever you said, or we just want more data?
You can make a recommendation. I agree with my thoughts. I mean, but it's really just a procedural thing that we can just do, because it's not really affecting the budget one way or the other,
right,
per se. I mean, it's
what is adding line items.
Yeah,
that's pretty much a controller issue.
Yeah, so we'll just do it. You guys,
it has a physical impact though.
Yeah, and it should be in the report. I mean, I think it's a
motion away. So
we wouldn't have come up with the idea about
yeah.
Yeah.
Whose motion is it?
So she needs to formalize the motion because she made a suggestion first. She did not say, I move to.
Okay, so I move to make a motion to create a departmental operational budget for management of hurricane-related expenses.
Significant event?
Or significant event, yeah, something significant.
And then we can have a definition of significant event, hurricanes and other natural disasters.
Do we have a second?
I'll second that.
Public comment?
Public comment?
I presume we can turn this around. Is this on? Is this working? Sounds like it. John Fergus, 135 Maple. Good idea. We're moving off hurricanes. How about emergency management operations or something like that? I'm thinking of something, heaven forbid, if we had a school, an armed person at school, you can imagine the police department over to all kinds of stuff go on. Fire department, they're all prepared. Could be we had a tanker overturn on 130 several years ago. That could have turned very nasty. So there's all kinds of things that could happen. The more, and I'm sure staff can work out some kind of details. Another point, though, is how you fund that. You've been doing a lot of stuff. There's two things I suggest. I don't know whether either of them's legal. One of them is an assessment. We have a stormwater assessment. We could have a fire assessment. And the city in the past, in the 90s, when they first adopted the utility tax, council did a quid pro quo. They told the public, we're going to do a utility tax. It's going to bring in this much money. We're going to reduce your millage the same amount. So they didn't see a change, but what they saw, the millage went down, the money stayed the same. The key here is the state says no more than 10 mils. They don't tell you how big your assessment can be. Now, I don't know whether you could do an assessment for emergency management or not. Another possibility is MSTU, Municipal Service Taxing Unit. Now, that has a millage attached to it, but I'm not sure how that plays with the 10 mil. Okay, so the assessment probably is the only other route. But and there may be some other bizarre way, I don't know. But those are the only ones I've heard. But I think it's a good idea. I like the idea of building it fast as far as whatever this is. And one thought that comes to mind is the city in round numbers has been talking, we're going to lose $600,000 through the third homestead. I'd be interested in, if you raised the millage, the assessment, whatever your income is, by that amount, okay? So the city comes out the same, you take the extra money and you stick it into this emergency response business, and you tell people, when we get that too, name the number, 1.5 mil, 2 mil, whatever seems appropriate, we're going to drop it out again.
So I didn't follow that. I lost track of what did you
I didn't totally love it.
Okay. The city is going to, quote, lose the number I'm hearing, 600,000 because of the third. If you raised the millage enough to basically grab that back, okay, the people that had that third homestead don't see a change. They don't get the benefit because the millage has been raised enough to offset it. Now, the question with that is, those folks like Andrew that don't have that homestead protection, they're probably going to get hammered. I don't know how bad that is for somebody that has a home that's not homesteaded or that doesn't have the third homestead. Or a business
where their assessed value is too low.
Yeah, or however it works, and I'm not real clear on that. So you'd have to look at that and what is the adverse impact on the people, because what that third homestead is, it's a shell game. They're taking the money from one set of taxpayers and saying, here, you can have it here. And all I'm saying is the city says, we're not going to play the game. We're going to take it from the people that, okay? So I don't know how that all plays out. I haven't had time to think all the details, but I'm just trying to provide more food for thought. And again, another point, you've talked about a hurricane. We went through a period of about 10 years when we really didn't have any activity, and that's part, that's natural. No question, it goes up and down. Well, we're back into the active period. But what we're seeing is an active period that's more active than it's been before. So if you went back to the last active cycle, how many times did the city, this area, get hit with a hurricane? Okay, I remember David, a bunch of them that went through. No, no, I'm going back into the 70s, 80s now. Oh, that's a good joke. That you might want to think about during, if we're in that type of a cycle, it's not one storm every 5 years. It may be a storm every year for 5 years. Yeah, and that's the point I'm making, that we never had what was the one that hit Houston? We never had an Irma before. Okay, these are one-of-a-kind storm. We are in a new normal. And so you probably begin to think about, if we had a storm a year for 5 years in the last cycle, you'd say, okay, maybe five or six storms. And speaking about how much it costs per storm, Charlie came through and was a few hundred thousand dollars. Before 2004, the worst, the city, I'm not talking about the city, I'm talking everybody in the city. Okay, talking to Don Hughes. It had been hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of damage. Okay, Charlie was kind of the same. Francis and Jean, if I recall, the number was something like $6.7 million. Orders of magnitude larger.
And that was at the value of the dollar then.
Yeah, in 04.
Yeah, so that 6.7 today, the net present value would be a whole lot more.
Yeah, so the point is that you've begun discussing preparing for this. It's not unpredictable. Over a period of 50 years, you know you're going to get hit. So it's just when and how big and how often. But you can begin to develop, and I guess I'm talking about developing kind of a budgeting model for this line item that says how often might, and this is probably a discussion that somebody like Hughes could probably play with it and come up with, geez, your emergency manager anyway. How many storms should you plan for? How much damage kind of on general? And what will probably happen is, if things work right, you build up a nice number, and you'd probably say there's a peak number. Once we're at this number, I mean, if you're at $10 million, you'd say, hey, that's probably enough, so let's cool it. Because really, the problem is not trying to cover everything. It's the cash flow issue, I think, is the real issue. And so if you can build enough to say, we'll survive a seat a year, if you had to, and if it were like an assessment, you can change an assessment every year, that you could just go in and say, guys, we just depleted it. We've got to build it up again. You're going to get hammered this year. And if people understood that's the way we're doing it, because if you don't, it means during the storm, our guys go across the river and that's it. We're done. Or the debris sits there for 6 months while the county actually gets cleaned up. And another suggestion on that line is, I forgot to bring my notes, but anyway, perhaps you could the city could work a retainer with somebody, and it might cost you something every year, that you know that they are the ones that are going to have to come here, and they know they're the ones that'll have to come here when there's a storm, end of discussion, because you're on contract. So, anyway, I've got other stuff, but I forget what it is, and I think I've rambled enough here, but trying to give you something else to think about.
That's good stuff.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think in regards to what you hear Mr. Fergus say, in regards to the motion, we want to be careful of giving them a direction that's an unfunded mandate. We've heard about that, right? So to say to create a line item without having some inkling of how to fund it, I guess. We want to be careful about that. So do we want to vote on the motion then, or do you want to amend the motion based on this conversation, or?
Let's,
No further discussion, roll call, or no?
Any other committee comments? Or should we vote on the motion?
Okay. Andrew Schler?
Yes.
Millie Sims?
Absolutely.
Larry Whitney?
Yes.
Cindy Berger?
Yes.
Vice Chairman Rucker?
Yes.
No, it sucks.
Okay, so congratulations, you made your first
recommendation.
Thank you. And I think this puts us on a good track towards many more recommendations, so I appreciate it. All right, so officially I was going to leave general fund and just move through the other funds real quick, since we gave you that latest forecast. Unless somebody wants to go around and general fund a little bit more on those rates and things, but I'm not seeing that. Okay. All right, so I'm moving on to the stormwater, please. 5-year forecast for stormwater. Yes, the second page. It is a little bigger. This one's a little bigger.
Is it?
Yeah. It's the first bigger.
But it's not that one.
Going on the one
page.
Page.
Not my page.
No. Going right to the one back. Jim's here.
You passed it already.
Yeah, the back. Here, pass it over. I'll get you there. It's okay.
Dang it.
It's on the screen reader.
Okay. So, this 5-year forecast is, I guess, reasonably similar to the first one I gave at the beginning, in that it reflects the increase to the rate to 200 as we discussed at the very beginning of all this. So, essentially what happens over the 5-year plan is the revenue would start in 1819 and would go up to 1 million versus the 512,000 that we currently have. And what this actually is going to enable us to do is to get close to, but not 100% at, the projection that we now have from Stormwater Master Plan, which did come in. So did you email them the entire plan?
No, I gave them all a hard copy of this.
So in front of you, you do have a spreadsheet that's too tiny for most of the human eyes to see. I'm about to do that. But what we'll make sure to do is email you the actual entire Stormwater Master Plan report so you can read the preceding pages, because they tie to this spreadsheet. The summary of the spreadsheet is that the engineers have given us a 10-year plan for getting all the infrastructure where it needs to be, doing all this repair and replacement stuff, and you can see all the details, and they tell you if it's for replacement of old stuff, or if it's for treatment because we have to deal with water quality issues, or if it's for conveyance to make the pipes bigger to deal with the increased volume. You know, there's all these different things at play. The total for the 10-year program that they've given us is $6.7 million. And what they have said in the report essentially is that we should have about
I think it was $670,000 or so program each year to do this in 10 years. That was essentially what they said. So what this allows us to do, this stormwater fund budget at 200 ERU rate, we fund about $650,000 each year. We substantially start this project in 1920, fiscal year 1920. So if you look at the line kind of in the middle of the stormwater budget, it says stormwater master plan projects. There's nothing in 17-18, and then 18-19 we put 560,000. In 1920 we're essentially able to gear up. No, 1920 we've got on the stormwater master plan project line, there's 650,000. I'm sorry, the other spreadsheet, Andrew, the 180.
Oh.
So the stormwater master plan project line, kind of in the middle there. So I guess what I'm saying here is that this is showing with our revenues and expenditures, we would be able to fund about $650,000 of projects every year. We can actually do a little bit more though, because when you look at the very bottom, our net position shows that we have positive cash, so we could use a little bit more if we needed to on the projects and get this done in 10 years. And that was one of your questions, Gavin.
Yeah, and this is great. This is what I was looking for. This is a static report. The requirement for repair every year is going to increase. It doesn't go back to the static.
They built in
Maybe you just changed priorities.
Well, they did build in a figure for maintenance. In addition to
their regular maintenance built into that figure. So when she sends me the actual report, you'll see the summary that talks about an R&R repair and replacement figure, which would be like the annual, if we need to replace the culvert, we need to, little things that we have to do. These are the major replacement.
Okay.
Rest, like big repairs.
Okay. My thought process from the very beginning, and thank you for this, this is pretty much what I was looking for, except that it includes maintenance and repair. What I was looking for is if we get rid of all this backlog of replacing pipe and everything, what would be the cost run rate of maintaining the system? So that if I'm spending $1 million a year now, maybe by year 11 it's only $200,000 a year, and that's it.
By year 11, we'll have done another stormwater master plan, which will identify a whole another big round of projects. Because the problem with stormwater is it never ends. So last year, 10 years ago, when we did our stormwater master plan, the volume of water that we dealt with was a completely different animal. The water quality standards were completely different. All that's changed in the last 10 years. So we know that in 10 years, that the whole game changes.
You know,
it may change in 5 years,
it
may update in 5 years.
So you're saying that stormwater you're trying to plan to eradicate it, and I think I'm going to say thing we can do is look at it in 10-year windows, because that's standards we know we can live with, identify, and manage, and then we'll get up.
That's the time period we feel like we have known conditions.
What is the initial life of the pipes?
It depends. It depends on the type of pipe.
What? What's that?
And where they're located. So some that are sitting in the water table, like close to South Parker, disintegrate a little faster because of the conditions that are.
No question.
In a year, it could be anywhere between 30 and 50 years.
So I'm putting in a 30-year to 50-year pipe that we're going to have to replace in 10 years.
No,
because this isn't replacing all.
This isn't replacing every pipe in the city in 10 years.
This is getting everything back.
You're not going to replace this. You're going to be replacing other pipes.
Correct.
Okay.
Right. Yes.
Then I feel better. Okay.
So we just reevaluate our plan every 10 years. Sometimes every 5 years. It depends on if we know the conditions have changed so much, then we'll do it faster.
You have to react to. You know, environment, there's no question. I just don't want to put in 50-year pipe and replace it in 10 years.
That's right.
That's what I'm garnering from this.
No, we can't do that. We're worse at doing the opposite.
I know.
And so this plan has nothing to do with the military. It's all achieved for the year.
Correct.
Got it.
It's a one-time fee for people who don't have a mortgage. It's, if you have a mortgage, it's added into your.
So even.
It's part of.
With what we see today that we have to replace, we're still 10 years out to get all that done.
The other thing too is, this is actually very aggressive though, I have to say. Because we also have to, like, for example, we try to say this with the new plan too. We can only do so much physically in one timeframe. So we can have all the money in the world, but we won't spend it. That matters because we can't do it physically, you're trying to hire more people, you know. So this is a pretty aggressive plan to get it in shape. And we can handle doing that.
Okay.
And so, like I said, we'll send you the full report, which I've prepared, so I meant to get that whole thing to you. But just as a reminder, the engineer will be discussing this report and will be discussing other infrastructure needs that are actually funded out of general funds in the capital assets.
But this $6.8 million number is the number I really wanted to know about.
Correct, yes.
Because I did not understand the size of the problem.
So anyway, so just as a reminder, June 20th is when we have the workshop to actually go through this report, talk about other infrastructure issues. So if you're able to attend that, that's a Wednesday at 6 p.m. It's before our regular
right.
council meeting.
So since you want to go to council meeting, you just come out early.
Yeah. I need to get that on my calendar.
The infrastructure workshop would be very informative.
Well, it's normal, and I remember when David, I guess, was the engineer who said this $6 million number is what it's going to take.
He was right on.
So when we talk about like having to take out financing for equipment, things like that, we don't really like to do that. You know, you should be able to pay for things that in cash, right? But we had to because of decisions prior to us being here that put things off to the point where we had to do that. So when we got, for example, our car replacement program back online, they'll tell you, I am very reluctant to put anything off again because I know that if you get off course, then we're going to have to pay it up later and it's more expensive.
Sure.
Like Roosevelt Avenue, when we did that project, it was $1.2 million. If we hadn't waited for, how long was it, 20 years to do that, it would have been $300,000. So the longer you wait on infrastructure, the more cost. So it's important that that's why we're. You'll see me when I'm sitting in a workshop with the infrastructure party on that, not to postpone this.
Do you approve for accumulated depreciation against these capital projects?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
So that money's already set aside for replacement.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Are you guys going to put any trees along that Roosevelt sidewalk? It's real hot walking
down. We really talked about that, but we have to have cooperation with the property owners. Sidewalk takes up the right way, yeah.
Oh, really? On that thing on that ditch side where
yeah.
They throw all the trash out?
Yeah. Okay. Well, the ditch side is actually a swale, and that's a stormwater conveyance.
Oh, okay. That's a place for trash now. It's a nice sidewalk.
The side of the houses is much nicer because you have trees. But on the other side, if we can get cooperation with some of those homeowners to put some trees along that, that would be great, but we don't have space to do it ourselves.
What prevents us from getting that cooperation? Are people just ornery or?
Well, I think we should wait about a year, at least, or so, because people, there's still some homeowners on that roof that are still upset that we just sidewalk in. So they're going to be like, yeah, they're still, because they, you know, to their defense, they took care of that right away, most of their, you know, as a power line, they had that home, so they thought it was theirs, you know. And then we came in and said, hey, we're going to stick sidewalk in there. So some of them, there's some homeowners that they're still mad.
This is off topic, but it's just a real quick point. When the state offers these programs, like another $25,000, they should also consider raising the cap on the millage rate
because the woman is expensive to the localities, and now we're boxed in. Well, unless the state is trying to take over the city.
I always thought the state, if they really wanted to lower their taxes, they should lower the sales tax.
Right.
Because that would affect their budget, but when they lower taxes, they lower our taxes. So.
Okay.
All right, that's all I wanted to say on stormwater, unless there's any other questions. I'll move right along. Okay, all right, so the next page, one over, is the CRA budget, which looks kind of crazy with all the extra rows in here. I'm not asking you actually to look at this one really, because.
But before we just go over, I guess I just want to ensure again, so you're all agreeing to double the assessment? Taking it from $100 to $200, and because I made a motion for it and it fell flat, so I guess we are okay.
Is that, do you guys want to make that recommendation?
Which recommendation?
Because by default, I guess, right?
Right, because we're building the budget on this scenario right now, so.
It's going to be a staff recommendation, because it.
I already tried to make a motion on it, so.
Well, I guess, yeah, I mean, that failed. So I don't know if you all wanted to make a motion to implement the staff recommendation for this, or if you don't have to make a motion on this one, or if you don't want to. That's you all.
Let's try it again. I make a motion. I'd like to move to make a recommendation in our report that we do not raise the ERU, and leave it at the existing $104 per property.
Any seconds?
Just wanted to clear. So we don't want to modify it, then we're just going to accept your recommendation. So.
But I don't think that means exactly that. Just because we didn't take your motion doesn't mean by default that we're recommending.
I think it does, right?
Okay, that's what he's saying.
To be clear, I'll make a motion to use the recommendation to raise the ERA to 200 for the stormwater management.
Why do we have to?
I'll second.
It's the right thing to do, I think, right?
Yeah, I mean, because basically it's going to be another thing you can put in your report if you think about it. You know, you've made a decision on another aspect of the budget that you reviewed, you've given us your thoughts. I mean, it's probably cleaner that you do these votes, even if you're just saying go with the recommendation. I think that is the right choice.
We'd like to know if you agree. I mean, that's the whole point of you guys.
Yeah, I mean, that's the discussion, right? I mean,
So do we vote on that?
Public comment, because you're
public.
John Fergus, 135 Maple. Have a failed motion for no change. Have a motion for the full amount. If before you vote, you discuss, you might want to discuss, and I think I'm sensing maybe there's some place in between that somebody'd like to go. That may be a discussion to have before you have the vote. I think that's my main point on this one, that you may want to search among yourselves whether there's an intermediate position of some sort. And again, maybe it's you ramp it up over 2 or 3 years or something. I don't know. I'm just suggesting that it need not be black or white. There are shades of gray. Maybe not 50 shades, but there are shades of gray.
Whoa.
John.
Wow.
Okay.
John.
I love that. Oh, man.
Setting the record?
No, it's on the record now.
I guess I would say, I don't want to double the rate either, but I also lean on the expertise of the staff, and so, you know, I'm kind of leaning toward, you know, the recommendation, because like you said, if it's politically, you know, if the council will go for it, it'll be stopped that way, but I guess that's why, where I'm leaning is following the staff's recommendation.
I see it this way, and it's for lack of not knowing what the staff did, but to Josh's point in terms of this shades of burden, I don't know that it was brought up that $300 or $400 was the raise, and you settled back at $200, so that might already be the negotiated spot that's most palatable. So it was up to me, this stormwater thing, just, this is a personal thing, it drives me crazy. It was up to me, I made it $300 and moved this 10 years out to $7. Just words. But I'm willing to live with $200 because we can't be right, you know, there has to be some balance here. So that's my perspective on it.
And just to give you some information that, and the summary is a good summary, so we'll send that out. So so you guys can, if you want to change your mind the next meeting, that's fine. But just so you know, this plan is based on what we actually need to do in this 10 years to deal with the system that we have now. And so we did not scale back on the project here. It's all of the projects in here meet the intent of the TMDL requirements that we have to meet for crawling, total maximum daily load reduction requirements. So you clean it, so we're cleaning the water, really we're basically doing. So it meets those standards, and then it also meets the repair replacement standards that we need to do, in addition to sizing the conveyance system to deal with the increased storm volumes that we're getting. And all that model with climate change and sea level rise. So all of that data is used to create this plan. So none of it will scale back. This is what we have to do to meet our current requirements. The fee is basically smooth this over, because all these projects take multi-years. So we'll start in 1 year, but it'll roll over sometimes 2 or 3 years until it's completed. So we just took the amount and smoothed it down the line, which is fine. We will be able to do those projects with the amount that we gave here in this plan. So that's a cost feasible plan, and it's actually what we need to do. You'll see, and for me, and Public Works, we will not scale back infrastructure for political reasons. I will always give the council what we have to do. They can scale back, but you won't see that from me.
Each one of these projects is executed by our own power and our own Public Works employees, or we hire people to do most of these projects.
So
I think Mr. Potter said that we have like two people that are dedicated to stormwater and his crew.
We have
four people, yeah. Mm-hmm. And they're doing just repair and replace right now, or are they starting to execute any of these projects? Or?
We can do some pretty large scale pipe replacements on our own. And that we pull other people off other jobs to do that, because a lot of Public Works people can do big projects. So we can do it, but we can't do, a lot of this will be done through a contractor.
So if we start accumulating this pile of money, we'll be able to spend it on the projects, or will we be accumulating more money than we can possibly spend in the time that the personnel and people we can do?
This is doable for us. If I thought that we could do more, we would scrunch it up faster. Do you see what I'm saying?
One of the concerns that I see coming out of that group is that they put people in these projects, okay? They do a fine job, don't get me wrong, but they're being pulled off something else that they were hired to do, and those things are falling behind, so we're just putting out fires.
That's right.
On top of that, when they have things scheduled, many times it can't be done on a schedule simply because there's an emergency somewhere else. That's why I like to see all this stuff get caught up, because there's nothing more expensive than running people all over the place and not getting the resources to get done. That's a big problem in the city.
Yeah, that is a concern. But luckily, the last pipe cave-in that we had was in the winter. wasn't going to be summer, a lot of money to pay town. But most of these large-scale projects will be done by a contractor. Because, honestly, because we don't, it's more cost feasible to do that than having people here all the time. You see what I'm saying? So.
Well, that's equipment to milling machines and grinding machines and digging machines.
So unless we're going to do that 24 hours a day, all the time, there's no purpose to have that stuff. You know, we don't do that all 24 hours a day. So we keep our, we have employees that can do emergency pipe replacements and things like that, but we refer for planned projects to go out to.
Is this, I mean, we have this plan in front of us. Is this the first time we've had this plan, or is this an update to the plan? The price is increasing over time, I guess.
Yeah. The only time it went down was in 2008.
Recession.
Yeah, and then of course, nobody had money to do anything. It was still killing me.
So this is also based on, when they put a rate out here, like the year five, it's based on expected expense, cost drivers then, as opposed to this. Now.
Billy, do you have a comment?
I just had a hard time following his question.
Yeah, we're both talking the same time.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Mr.
I was just clarifying some procedural things with that, Mr. Reckert.
Yeah, I believe we're ready to vote.
Okay.
Okay. Andrew Schlauer?
No.
Millie Sims?
Yes.
Larry Whitney?
Yes.
Cindy Berger?
Yes.
Vice Chairman Reckert?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay, so since we're in the last 15 minutes, before I proceed, and I'll do CRA and capital assets real quick, the last two documents. Before I do that, though, does anybody have any other topics you wanted to use our time to discuss these last few minutes, other than what I'm going to cover? Topics related to things you've seen at the other presentations that you wanted to bring up that we haven't had a chance to actually fully vet as a group? Okay. I'm not hearing anything, so I just want to throw that out. So on the CRA side of this, the only real change to this document is that we wanted to fully reflect how the revenues and the flow of funds will change in the CRA based on which millage rate we collect. The original forecast version we gave you, the five-year forecast for the CRA, you're on the right page. Come. That's it, CRA? So the original version we gave you was just really, I think, based off of one millage rate and the revenue and expenditures there. So that's why this is so much busier. But if you wanted to basically check against the general fund and the CRA and how those dollars flow when we pick a different millage rate, that's what this is trying to give you. But I realize it may be information overload. Does anybody need a quick refresher on how the CRA money affects the general fund? Because we talked about that, you know, some meetings back.
Is there anything we can do at all about the CRA money and how it's going?
It's pretty much a lot.
And it's a good point.
Yeah.
Okay. But you're saying the fund increases in size over the years. Why are we still putting money in the CRA fund if we dissolve the CRA?
Well, all the time that is, when we change the millage rate, that changes the size of the revenue one way or the other. And the CRA continues out because there's debt to pay down still, even when we stop the project.
Debt hopefully goes down, and that doesn't increase over time, right?
Is it a fixed amount, or does it start to fall off? Or I don't remember.
The payments are probably the same year.
Yeah, they are here, yeah, it looks like, yeah.
It's very good, yeah.
So legally, you can't dissolve it. And the last year of debt is the last year that the CRA was going to legally exist anyway. So
what's your retirement?
26. 26 even beyond this 5 year plan.
Yeah, so it's just something we have to stick in and look how big that debt.
Yes, that keeps on using get 4.1 million this is one.
Yeah.
You're all gonna have to do.
So this is just a math exercise. It is one of the
exactly.
Do we have to make any movements on it or what?
I don't have to need it on that one.
Great.
Seriously, on the CRA, if over time you're getting more revenue for the CRA because military is going up, then what do you do with the extra money? The extra money? You pay it down, you can't pay it down further. It goes into general fund?
You get the revenue, you subtract the debt, you do 65 back to the general fund.
Okay, so it's through your revenue.
To the Park County.
And then you have this cost line item to pay the debt, but the funds are through your revenue.
Right.
And really the main reason for the revenue going up is the valuation of properties increasing.
Yes.
So you're getting more revenue.
Yes.
Mr. Whitney made an interesting comment there. Can we pay the debt down faster? Can we make double payments or anything?
It says swap loan. I don't know if you're familiar with those.
What's it called?
Swap financing.
Yeah, well, I'm not that familiar with swaps, but.
I know it's a consolidation thing or something.
So we have managed an interest, low interest rate, but it makes it harder that you can't.
Yeah, when you try to pay off early, you can, you have, we'll keep looking at it because there, I think there's a potential, there's a point where rates are all beautifully aligned. But right now we haven't gotten to that point where we wouldn't be further in the hole.
But this is a fixed rate debt?
It's a fixed rate that we pay, and then depending on what the swap rate is, decides whether or not we pay more than that interest rate or less than that interest rate.
Okay.
And so at this point, if we were to pay it off, we would pay more than we owe, so there's no reason to do that right now.
And what's the swap credit on government security?
On the LIBOR rate?
On what? Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so every year or every month when it goes through, that's what it is.
It's an international rate.
Yeah.
Come on, capital assets.
Well, the reason I was asking is because if we have a low fixed rate, then inflation will eat it up over time, and we have to be so concerned.
And I am watching it. I try to keep an eye on it every month to kind of see, at some point when it comes to a point where it looks like we would actually benefit from paying it off, then sure.
Just get it broken down.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Nice.
I remember when they called me and said, you guys still have $4 million left on that line of credit. I was like, no.
Okay.
Thanks for asking.
Thank you for reacting.
All
right. Two pages. So the difference in capital assets fund this version compared to where we were before. Number one, based on what we already looked at in the general fund, we're putting more money into this fund to fund our infrastructure needs, because we're proposing the higher military. So toward the top of the page is a line that says transfer from general fund. Maybe it's about four lines down, I guess. Transfer from general fund, you can see in 17-18 it's 247,000.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so it goes long across, and those are the same numbers we saw on general fund side, so putting more money there. The other thing that's different is, again, because we're moving more money into this fund from general fund based on ad valorem going up, we are not proposing an increase to the utility tax until 21-22. That's where you can notice that the capital asset revenue line at the top goes from 780 to 980,000.
Mm-hmm.
That's where that extra $200,000 in revenue would come from if we chose to increase utility tax at that point in the future.
As opposed to doing it now.
Correct. Correct. And those are the only other changes, other than we've shifted projects around and tried to kind of, do the minimal amount we can in the upcoming years so that we, can just do what we can with the revenue we're putting into it. And if you go to the very last page, that will show you where we end up in that fund. For example, if you look at total net position, the very last line, That shows you, at the end of 17-18, we have a little bit of a balance, $255,000, that could carry forward to the next year to start covering those projects. You'll notice that in 19-20 and 2021, we have a hole. It's a hole we think we can, just sort of move things around and push some stuff out probably and fill. Because we could also, though, to be fair, we could also do the utility tax increase earlier. We're just trying to push that out as long as we can, and maybe we won't need to, but it's just, this is a plan we can work with. So,
So how are we, the committee is a group that, again, with your political crystal ball evaluation, you're saying it would be better for a military increase storm plan that increases the DR review. But you don't want to increase a utility tax for capital.
Yeah, we're trying not to do it, hit everybody with everything all at once. I mean, as much as we could avoid it.
Part there is that it's a matter of presentation, and it's a matter of bringing the expectations of the community up to where they need to be. The general consensus is, if I walk down the street and I said to somebody, oh, by the way, do you mind if we raise taxes? Of course they're going to say no. They don't want to pay the taxes that they're paying. But even though they'll hate it, they'll understand that there's a value proposition. So not only do we have to incorporate in presentation that we're raising this, but where do you get the money? Okay, and how do we maintain the city and the thoughts and feelings and the value sets that we want. Those things have to be communicated. You do one side without the other, it's anger. It's just pure anger. Mm-hmm. Does it make sense?
Yeah, I agree.
It's a terrible word in our society. I mean, it goes back thousands of years. You know, taxes is just a horrible thing.
Anyway, so is anyone making a motion specific to utility taxes, or want to discuss this a little bit more? Or?
I don't think you're recommending to raise the utility taxes this year, right?
Not now.
Just the ERU, the ERU, and just the
FDA. Well, maybe we should recommend.
You better try.
Make a motion.
I mean, you're probably going to pass, to tell you the truth.
I think what we're showing though is if we could get a transfer from general fund into the capital assets, we can cover that gap in capital assets.
Moving forward.
Right. Until we need to finance fire station. And that would be the fire station.
And brand new fire station.
Well, the public works first. You think you could do the public works, you know, but I see that for sure first, I think.
Yeah. So we're planning on, would like to fund the public works building. And that would start in year 1920. Mm-hmm. And then, but we wouldn't do the fire station until 2022.
So where is public works building?
The same project. Jackson. We engineer and architect those two buildings at the same time. We would just build public works first and the fire station. We add on the fire station.
We just.
A little more central location, maybe we can shed a couple of dollars.
Oh my God, right?
No, we really need to
If we do, I'm cutting for Andrew.
We could take off the tires or something.
Yes.
Oh my God. Yeah.
Let us take the tires.
Oh, no.
I did this.
Okay, so since we're at 9 o'clock, that's all I had to cover with you. I know it was a lot again, but I really appreciate everybody sharing a lot of ideas and communication.
So are we going to get more recommendations into the report?
No, we made a good start, and like I said, this is going to generate momentum, I think, at our next couple of meetings where we can brainstorm. So this is good. So next week, two presentations. We'll give you the updated ideas list based on stuff we talked about. I'm also going to add in the motions you've already made, because that's going to go in the report, so I'll put those in there. We will send you the full stormwater master plan report, and
so the ideas that we didn't get to, so I just need to put an email to whom do I direct it to get my ideas on this idea list?
Yeah, you can email them to me. That'd be totally fine, and I'll make sure they're on there.
Okay. If you have them beforehand, yes.
And over there, so we were talking about revenue streams.
Yeah, send me your ideas. Anytime, day or night, send them over.
Just don't see anybody.
Yeah, Joe, what?
Don't copy anybody. Just send it directly to our
Right, and then we
And she can always distribute.
And then I'll put it in the document for next time.
There are some revenue stream ideas.
Great.
Have you thought, thinking?
I like it.
That means gentleness.
Yeah.
We like that.
Yeah.
Do we have a motion to adjourn?
I make a motion to adjourn.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, 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 who seconded?
Vice Chairman?
I'll second. Vice Chairman Reckers, motion to adjourn.
I think Millie made it.
Millie made it, yeah. And then Shadar second.
Oh, I thought, I'm sorry. I'll second Ms. Sims' motion to adjourn.
Okay. Okay, we're good, all right.